Good afternoon, everyone. And the first item of business this afternoon is a debate on motion number 13045 in the name of Keith Brown on making the most of the contribution of veterans to Scotland. I'd invite members who wish to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, please. And I now call on the Cabinet Secretary, Keith Brown, to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, a generous 14 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, in August last year, I appointed Eric Fraser as the first Scottish Veterans Commissioner. Indeed, that was the first such post in the United Kingdom. With some reservations, I think, subsequently, which have receded, his appointment was welcomed by members across the Chamber, who adopted a non-partisan position in keeping with the real, genuine and tangible cross-party accord to provide the highest possible support and opportunities for our armed forces, for our veterans and their families who choose to make Scotland their home. Members recognise that the way in which public services and support for veterans were provided in Scotland were good, but they were developing and they were improving. But I acknowledged, as others did, that more could, should and would be done to ensure these are coherent and as good as they could be. A commissioner, we agreed, could bring that holistic perspective to our and our partner organisations' policy development, challenging perceptions and bringing experience and independent views to bear on the issues of importance to veterans, holding those responsible to account also in order to drive further improvements. At the same time, the Commissioner also has a major part to play in promoting and highlighting the undoubted talents and skills of our strong and robust veterans community. This cohort of veterans is often an untapped resource that can and should offer so much to our communities, to employers and to Scottish society as a whole. Now, when he began his work, the Commissioner, Eric Fraser, spent a considerable length of time engaging with a wide range of interests, policy teams in local and Scottish Government, providers of services accessed by veterans, veterans organisations and, vitally, employers of veterans. Crucially, and in my opinion rightly, Eric invested a lot of time speaking to and hearing about the real-life experiences and opinions of individual veterans themselves. And who better to articulate how veterans are treated on leaving the military and returning to civilian life? Who better to spell out the difficulties they faced in finding a home, establishing a business, getting a job, developing skills and ensuring their families are settled? Who better as well to tell us what actually works in the real world, what needs improving and what needs to change? As a result of these discussions and a full and thorough examination of what's already in place, the Commissioner published his first report, Transition in Scotland, on 27th of March. He provided a copy of that report to Alec Ferguson as Chair of the Cross-Party Group on Veterans, and members can also find a copy in Spice. And I would congratulate the Commissioner on the tremendous progress that he has made to date, and I'd welcome his recommendations and his findings, because they can help us further improve the support that we provide to veterans. And to help and promote and publicise that report, I was delighted that Alec Ferguson very kindly hosted a reception here in Parliament on the 1st of April. Alec, Eric and I, and indeed many of the MSPs here, had the opportunity to meet key stakeholders, veterans and employers with a wide variety of experiences to share. And I hope that, like me, all those who attended found the evening informative, inspiring and incredibly worthwhile. I can think of two particular suggestions which were mentioned to me that night, which we've taken up since then. The reception itself focused on two main areas, employment and housing. And I was delighted that Eric and indeed Alex spoke so warmly about the steps the Scottish Government has taken in these areas to date, and felt able to echo my very strong belief that veterans and their families are a considerable and sometimes underutilised asset to the country. Now, the vast majority of veterans make a seamless transition from the military into employment, into business and into civilian life. They have a considerable, formidable and enviable skill set, sometimes a skill set of which they themselves are not as aware as perhaps they might be. They're leaders, they work well under pressure and they're adaptable, and they're also strategic problem solvers. They bring a whole range of real tangible skills as well as, for example, drivers, doctors, nurses, clerks, IT and communications experts, engineers and tradespeople. Exactly what we are looking for in a modern Scotland. And these skills that they develop have been forged and tested in some of the most demanding situations imaginable and have not been found wanting. And during the reception, I met veterans who had established businesses, who had built successful careers in the public and private sectors, and who gave their time freely in support of the third sector and their communities. They are, as we all are, fathers, mothers, friends and neighbours. They are an integral part of civic society, and they live in our cities, our towns, our Scotland. And I met small and large employers with specific recruitment policies in place to maximise the use of the undoubted skills of veterans. I also met veterans who found the whole experience, though, of leaving the military daunting and difficult. And it's vital that for that small number that require it, appropriate, effective and comprehensive support is readily available. The Commissioner's report, in my opinion, captures all of these views, these experiences and these opportunities. He's made recommendations of where we can work with a range of partners, such as local authorities and the Ministry of Defence, in order to further improve the support available to those leaving the armed forces who choose to make Scotland their home. And as I said a few moments ago, Presiding Officer, in broad terms, I welcome all these recommendations, and officials in the Scottish Government are now looking in detail at what we can do to take them forward. In the meantime, I'd make the following specific observations about some of the main areas that Eric has focused on. First of all, in relation to housing. I entirely agree with the Commissioner that service leavers wishing to settle in Scotland should be made aware of how housing legislation and systems work here. I should say, I've said now for a number of years, I believe the MOD and the UK Government should ensure that when somebody joins the armed forces on day one, a plan should be started for their employment and their housing and their health provision for when they leave the service. So we'll continue to work closely with the UK Government to ensure that advice and briefings on housing and homelessness accurately reflect the position here in Scotland, so that service leavers choosing to settle here are aware of the differences in policy and approach and where to go for assistance. We have produced a tailored housing options leaflet entitled A Scottish Housing Guide for People Leaving the Armed Forces and Ex-Service Personnel, which provides information on housing options and where to go for further advice and support. The guide was widely distributed to the Ministry of Defence, including military bases in the UK and abroad, as well as to advice and support agencies and social housing providers. For our part, Scottish Government officials will continue to monitor, to update and to ensure that any information available is accurate, informative and relevant, and they'll play their part in ensuring this gets to those who need it most. Housing is and will remain a priority for this Government, and access to good quality housing is a vital part of the Government's drive to secure economic growth, as well as to promote social justice, strengthen communities and tackle inequality. We also recognise that some service leavers and ex-service personnel can face particular challenges finding housing, and we are committed to working with the Commissioner and others to ensure that they are not disadvantaged by the service or the circumstances they find themselves because of this. We also wish to help social landlords understand their requirements and the flexibility that they have in allocating their houses, and we published the Social Housing Allocations A Practice Guide, which includes guidance on housing issues for ex-service personnel and also encourages social landlords to give fair and sympathetic consideration to applicants leaving the armed forces. And the guide provides practical examples of approaches being used by landlords to manage allocations, including in relation to ex-service personnel. In relation to employment, the Transition in Scotland report identifies a range of ways that we and others can help those leaving the armed forces. It identifies also, of course, the UK Government and the MOD. To help those leaving the armed forces find a job, clearly one of the most crucial aspects of making a successful transition. And my officials will explore further how best we might promote modern apprenticeships, placements, employer recruitment of service leavers, and crucially, refine, develop and improve the mechanisms for getting the right information and advice to the service leaver. I think if you think about it for a moment, some of the advice and the number of organisations which stand ready to help veterans, you know, at least 400 charities, for example, can be of such a scale that it can blind the person coming out to where the right place is to go for the best possible support. And I agree that the wealth of youth employment initiatives and opportunities that the Government supports and delivers through partners like Skills Development Scotland should be very clearly signposted to early service leavers and veterans. It's important that this group are aware of the range of offers and opportunities for them to make a successful transition to civilian life. It's not clear that the support available via the third sector organisations and charities is sufficiently well publicised, coordinated and aligned with the mainstream offers which are already available in Scotland via Skills Development Scotland and colleges, particularly for those veterans under 25 years of age. I agree there are opportunities to better align, to publicise and to link the network of veteran support services offered across Scotland through My World of Work and other partners' websites. And my officials have discussed this with Skills Development Scotland, who advise that they will be happy to work with partner organisations to fulfil this recommendation. I think one thing that struck me as being very important over the years now which I've been responsible for veterans in the government is that very often that transition to civilian life can be the most daunting thing that they've experienced, even including those very dangerous experiences they may have had whilst in the armed forces. The idea of having to be responsible for, first of all, getting a job, getting a house sometimes, budgeting in that house, holding down a tenancy, these things can be quite a daunting prospect for people who very often will have had their accommodation, their food, their wage, their travel options provided or at least organised for them. That itself can be a very worrying experience. So for those reasons, I think the Commissioner's recommendations are both timely and welcome. And he identifies, I think quite rightly, the importance of getting the preparatory work done correctly before and in the run-up to leaving the armed forces. We don't have responsibility for that, and if I'm honest, it's not always been easy to influence the Ministry of Defence in relation to that, and that's not just me saying that. I think you'd find the same comment being made in Wales and elsewhere. But Eric Fraser, because of his long experience, he was, I think, twice defence attaché in Washington, has worked with the Ministry of Defence. We're very hopeful that those links will help us to establish a more productive relationship in that regard. But he's already identified a number of ways in which the government, local authorities, public, private and third sectors can and should play their part to ensure that the information support provided at that crucial stage fully reflects the distinctive nature of devolved services in Scotland. And I want to push forward that agenda. And for my part, I would want to look to all strategic partners to play their full part, and I have no doubt that they will. We may not get it completely right immediately. I'm not pretending that we have it right just now. That's one of the reasons why I appointed the Commissioner. It's going to take time. Substantial effort will be required. But I would want to congratulate Eric on his excellent report. I think it struck the right balance between showcasing what is working well, what needs wider adoption, and where gaps need to be filled. And it holds up, crucially, I think, veterans and their families as assets to businesses, to society and to Scotland. And I think that key message, which was a central part of the reception that we held, must be recognised, endorsed and promoted. So that's a challenge for me, for the Scottish Government, the public and private sector, large and small, and for Scotland's ex-service charities. Can I just say a few words before closing, Presiding Officer, in relation to the Labour Party amendment? Now, I think the amendment is well-intentioned. The Scottish Government, for our part, support Puppy Scotland and a Legion Scotland's insult to injury campaign. And unlike other parties, we have included a specific pledge in our Westminster manifesto. But we believe that those who have been injured in the service of our country should get the full value of war disablement pensions. And we'll work to ensure that's not treated as income in the assessment of entitlement to other benefits. But I believe the right way to address that situation is for the UK government to align the war pension scheme with the AFCS so that there's a fair and consistent approach. Even if you think for a second or two about somebody, perhaps a veteran in a care home in Scotland who for very legitimate reasons is then moved to the rest of the UK and that entitlement which they had in Scotland doesn't transfer, that would be a real shock to the system. And that's the reason why I think it's best dealt with by a joint approach. And certainly.
Ken McIntosh.
The Minister recognised that Puppy Scotland and Legion are calling not on the UK Government to realign pensions, but specifically for the devolved administrations, including the Scottish Government, to realign its policy on care charges, that this is entirely a matter for devolved competence. It's got nothing to do with pensions. It's all to do with whether or not we charge those pensions.
There's quite a bit of time, Minister.
I think Ken McIntosh couldn't be more wrong. If he was aware of how the campaign started in the first place and the subsequent nature of the involvement of Legion Scotland and Poppy Scotland to a campaign which started in London, then he would know more about that. I spoke to Poppy Scotland actually on this morning. They were very surprised by this amendment. There had been no approach or discussion with the Labour Party in advance of this. The point I was going to make is that we are willing to explore this. We want to take a fair and consistent approach. While we explore with COSLA the options to create a fairer system for charging for social care to accept Labour's amendment, we've been passing on that cost to local authorities. I actually think we're trying to achieve the same thing here. And we have managed to have consensus in these debates in the past. And I know that consensus is really valued by the veterans community. So I would appeal I'm not saying right away, but during the course of the debate, for the Labour Party to think about this, I'm more than happy to meet to discuss it further so we can have a joint approach on this. I think we can get to the right place where we all want to be, but I don't think it would be useful to have the amendment carried forward. And I would ask the Labour Party if they would consider withdrawing the amendment even at this late stage. So just to conclude, Presiding Officer, this is obviously a challenge for me, the Scottish Government, the public and private sector, and that's large and small businesses, and for Scotland's ex-service charities. But we can and we will rise to this challenge. It's the right thing to do. Veterans and their families, we should not always think of them in terms of perhaps a problem with housing, perhaps a problem with coming back into society, or a problem with health, or even education or employment. We have to think of them in the vast majority as huge assets to our society who can offer a great deal. And sometimes it may be the case that they themselves don't exactly appreciate all the different skills and assets that they can bring to society, and it's down to us to make sure that can be remedied. Veterans and their families, given what they have given, I think deserve nothing less. Presiding Officer, I'm happy to move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call on Mary Fee to speak to and move Amendment 13045.1. A generous 10 minutes, Ms Fee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The care and treatment of our veterans is the manifestation of our humanity. How we treat those who gave all for their fellow countrymen and women, how we treat survivors and their families, declares the intent of our passion in society. And the United Kingdom Armed Forces Covenant places a duty on all of us to care for the survivors, the families and the bereaved. What the Transition in Scotland report by the Veterans Commissioner shows us is that while there are issues to be identified and work to be achieved, our health services, our housing agencies, third sector and voluntary organisations play a crucial role in the transition from military personnel to civilians, and we are rightly grateful for the dedication they show to making the transition as smooth as possible. And today at decision time, Scottish Labour will support the Scottish Government motion. The motion laid out by Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown is welcoming, non-partisan, and commits the Scottish Government and Parliament to tackle barriers faced by ex-servicemen and women when integrating into life after serving our country. The Labour amendment raises concerns that many MSPs will be aware of. We do not believe that injured veterans should be forced to face the cost of social care from compensation awarded, and that's the reason behind our amendment. We support the Insult to Injury campaign run by Poppy Scotland and the Royal British Legion, and I know that Ken McIntosh will address this further. And I'm pleased that the Cabinet Secretary has already made mention of our amendment, and I would like to stress that our in lodging the amendment, it's not intended to be mischievous or obstructive, but I think it would be remiss to have a debate about transition of veterans and not discuss this very important topic that is of concern to many thousands of people across the country. And Scottish Labour welcomes the report by the Commissioner. We support the findings and recommendations contained within the report. The four main themes of the report are all devolved issues, and where there is scope for the Chamber to work together, this must be our mission for the dignity of our ex-service men and women and our democracy. The transition for many, as Eric Fraser points out, can be smooth. And the earlier support is offered, then the easier that transition can be. However, for those unable to cope with the demands of civilian life, transition can be a very daunting and personal experience. One group identified as finding the transition more difficult is early service leavers. Early service leavers, classified as serving less than 4 years, often have the fewest formal qualifications and adult life experience. Leaving school and finding a role with the Army, Navy and Air Force is an act of bravery for many of our young men and women. The Commissioner talks of his concerns for early service leavers, recognised as especially vulnerable when they depart the armed forces. Homelessness is said to be widespread amongst early service leavers, with increasing numbers relying on friends and family to provide informal shelter and a temporary address, known as sofa surfing. This presents further problems in the transition process and can cause problems in finding employment. On employment, we read there are little differences between the experiences of early service leavers and those making their own transition from school to training or to employment. The Commissioner then warns that there must be further promotion of the Youth Employment Scheme to target early service leavers before and after leaving service. And with regards to the fourth recommendation, we fully support the Commissioner in calling for the opportunities for all age restrictions to be extended. This could have the desired effect of easing young early service leavers into civilian life. And furthermore, the Commission calls on the Scottish Government to consider including early service leavers as a targeted group. Presiding Officer, when reading the report, I queried whether there were any disparities between the experiences of early service leavers as well as service leavers between each of the armed services, the Army, the Royal Navy and the Air Force. And when summing up, I would be keen to hear from the Cabinet Secretary if any work has been undertaken to identify any issues, allowing those involved in planning for transitioning to target greater support where greater problems arise. And if he is unable to inform the Chamber, would the Cabinet Secretary be prepared to discuss this further in the near future? And I appreciate that this crosses over into a reserved issue, or indeed one for the armed forces themselves to identify. However, I will also be writing to the Veterans Commissioner to seek further clarity on the issue of disparity between services. And going back to the main themes of the report, housing is a substantial issue. Both recommendations offered regarding housing stress the importance of sharing information and cooperation between the UK and Scottish Government, local authorities and the armed forces. And we also join with the Commissioner in paying tribute to organisations such as the Scottish Veterans Residences, Houses for Heroes, Hague House, and in particular to myself, Erskine. And having visited Erskine a few times, I am proud to support them and the wonderful staff who carry out their duties in an exemplary manner. And I'm sure the same goes for all the other organisations I've also mentioned. Without these organisations, Scotland would be a poorer place, and long may the commendable functions of these historical organisations exist. Housing Options Scotland, who provide information and advice to veterans, as well as disabled and elderly people, are another example of organisations working in Scotland to better the lives of our ex-servicemen and women and deserve our full support. And, Presiding Officer, our health and wellbeing is important to each and every one of us. However, for those veterans having experienced the trauma of serving our country, it's crucial that the support is in place throughout their duties, transition and life onward to be a civilian. This Parliament is familiar with the importance of mental health, widely recognised to affect one in four of us in our lifetime. And in his report, the Commissioner states that reviewing the quality and availability of mental health services is well beyond the scope of the report, but is likely to be the subject of further work next year. And we fully support the Commissioner ahead of this future review and look forward to hearing how we advance mental health services for service leavers. And again, the Commissioner rightly praises the role of third sector and voluntary organisations in their efforts to support veterans and mental health in Scotland. Alcohol dependency and isolation can affect any person at any time, regardless of background and age. And the Commissioner warns that both need closer scrutiny and wider awareness following dialogue with veterans, clinicians and support agencies. And it appears that behind closed doors, problems are hidden. However, these can have disastrous consequences for the veteran's transition and the family, if not exacerbated by the transition process. The Forces in Mind Trust report Transition Mapping Study from 2013 estimates that the cost of poor transitioning in the UK totals around £110 million a year, with alcohol misuse the largest single effect, followed by mental health issues. No matter the economic cost, nothing compares to the costs on the lives of the ex-personnel, their families and communities. Yet, if we as a Parliament work with external stakeholders to make the transition process easier and seamless for more veterans, then the economic cost will decrease. But having a healthier and an active veteran community is greatly beneficial to all and must be our ultimate goal. The findings by the Commissioner on alcohol dependence and isolation is one where we will wait to see what develops as the Commissioner takes forward next year's programme. And finally, Presiding Officer, whilst this issue must never be used as a political football, and I doubt anyone in this chamber would seek to do that, I fully support the veterans' proposals made by Labour in our manifesto, and the SNP and Conservative manifestos also pledge support to veterans, and anything that brings further benefits to our ex-servicemen and women should be welcomed by all. In our manifesto ahead of next week's general election, Labour has pledged to strengthen the covenant between our nation and our armed forces, veterans and their families, to create a veterans register, to make certain our veterans receive proper support, to continue to roll out Labour's veterans interview programme, in which companies voluntarily guarantee an interview for job-seeking ex-forces personnel, and to introduce legislation to make discrimination against members of our armed forces illegal. Presiding Officer, the role of the military in the United Kingdom has long been the envy of many, if not all, countries around the world. From World War I to modern-day combat and peace missions, our armed forces deserve our full gratitude and respect for keeping Scotland and the United Kingdom safe. It can never be overstated how much we recognise and appreciate the sacrifices that many women and men have made over the years in securing peace at home and abroad. And I hope today's debate will be consensual and constructive, and I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call on Jackson Carlow. A generous 6 minutes, Mr. Carlow.
Presiding Officer, thank you. Can I begin by applauding the motion? Can I also thank the Cabinet Secretary, not just for the manner in which I think he addressed the motion this afternoon, but the manner in which he discharged his duties with respect to the veterans community. And I include in that those other ministers during the last 8 years who have done that too, Stuart Maxwell and Alec Neil, who I both recall from the cross-party group, which was founded in 2007, have always been concerned and very genuinely concerned to promote the issues that have been raised with regard to the veterans community. This afternoon's debate, as the Minister, Cabinet Secretary said, does have at its root an all-party and consensual approach, which has been very genuine and very important, as the Cabinet Secretary himself said, to the veterans community themselves. This is, of all issues, one in which I think none of us ought to allow ourselves to find a division growing on political grounds. The cross-party group, when it was founded in 2007, initially met with some resistance and suspicion because the Ministry of Defence itself regarded these issues as being almost reserved to Westminster, and it took some gentle persuasion and work to allow the Scottish Parliament to become more directly involved. Indeed, members of the Scottish Parliament in the early days were not always welcomed in military establishments, and it was quite a job to move to a point where they were. But as a consequence of that, I think there's a very broad recognition that Scotland, in its discharging of its obligations to veterans, is now a model anywhere within the United Kingdom to providing the best level of support possible. I agree with, I want to concur with the Cabinet Secretary's comments with regard to the Veterans Commissioner and commend what is very much an interim report, I think, on where we now are going forward with transition in Scotland. And it's interesting to me, really, that the very three issues that the very first cross-party group identified in 2007, housing, health and employment, remain at the core. That's not to say there hasn't been considerable progress on them, but I think we can see that these are the three issues around which the great debate takes place. It's difficult sometimes, I think, for members of the public to actually understand the underlying dynamic. They have become used to seeing parades of very brave people returning from areas of conflict and also watching those individuals in the discharge of their duties. And in some respects, I think, don't fully appreciate the enormity of the challenge that is represented, whether people have been in the services for a lifetime or in some cases only for a short period for a variety of reasons. As a teenager, I remember there was a popular film, well, actually it wasn't very popular at the time, it had nothing to do with the armed forces actually, it was called The Shawshank Redemption. I think most members have probably subsequently seen it. It was a very successful stage play in the Edinburgh Fringe a couple of years ago. But what it was very good at doing in an entirely different environment was actually showing the challenges that come from a slightly institutionalised environment where, yes, there is discipline, yes, there is comradeship, but there is also almost a reliance on the infrastructure that underpins the community that is there and the difficulties that can cause thereafter. At school, I was in the RAF Cadet Corps, and I have to say the armed forces looked like quite a seductive career option at one point. Sadly, as members will know, I'm blind as a bat, and although I was good at hitting targets, they were never my own. And that rather ruled out that. But I could see, having visited RAF camps around Western Europe at the time, when we, of course, were in the height of the Cold War, that it was a very inclusive community. And in a sense, when you were at school looking to it, you could see that for many people coming from a slightly chaotic or complicated background in life, it was going to offer a tremendous opportunity. And it does. But of course, the memory of what went before and the challenge that represents to those coming out of the armed forces is a huge responsibility that I think we can see from the work of the cross-party group and the government represents a considerable challenge. There's also been a huge change in public perception in the 1970s. We used to go backwards and forwards to school in our cadet uniforms. Then, during the Irish difficulties, all that stopped. And it's only in recent years that we have actually returned to members of the armed forces being seen with difficulties now again, but within the community sporting their uniform. And it has led to a huge public support, irrespective of the political judgments of governments with which the public are hugely and sharply divided, but a huge level of support for the armed forces themselves. Contrasted again with the atmosphere I recall growing up in the 1960s in the United States to veterans coming back from Vietnam, where they were, you know, pilloried by the public. We've avoided all of that. So that brings us to the challenges within the report. And I'm going to save quite a lot of what I want to say for my summing up remarks as well, Presiding Officer, in case you wondered if I was going to get to the point at some point in all of this. But there are three areas. First, of course, is in housing. And we know there are still challenges. The cross-party group last night heard from the Scottish Veterans Garden City Association that they have an enormous waiting list of people who are looking for housing. There is the issue of health, because when we first met as a group, many veterans came back with physical conditions which they had received excellent treatment for within the armed services, but then found themselves at the wrong end of an approach within the National Health Service, and they had to be introduced to the idea that they should ask for treatment, very many times too modest to actually insist that they should get any preference for that. And the issues of mental health have arisen since, alcoholism have arisen since, employment opportunities, and also the sustainability of the many charities that have underpinned the support of the armed services in recent years. These are issues to which I'll return in summing up. But the key in all of this, I think, has been information, coordination, collaboration and partnership between all the agencies and, I hope, between all the political parties at the same time.
Many thanks. There's quite a bit of time in hand today at the moment, so for those who wish, 7 minutes will be available to you, perhaps more, depending on how the debate progresses. I now call on Stuart Maxwell, to be followed by Dave Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Before I begin my speech, I'd like to say I very much welcome the tone of the first three speeches. I think the tone has been excellent in setting the scene for this particular debate. And I don't think Jackson Carlow, first of all, can I thank Jackson Carlow for his comments about myself, Alec Neil, and Keith Brown, very welcome, and I think that's very grateful for those comments. But I don't think Jackson Carlow should be too modest about his time in the Air Cadets, because I mean, it must have been very difficult flying those old biplanes and that, and I can understand why that would be quite difficult. But you did rather open yourself up to that then, I have to say, Jackson. But, Presiding Officer, for some time, I think there is still the case that there's been a perception that veterans are often seen as elderly, they are recognised only for service from long-ago wars. But a veteran, of course, can be someone who is young, who has served in recent conflicts, such as Iraq and Afghanistan. In fact, a veteran can even be someone who has not been deployed overseas at all. And of course, an example of that would be people who may well have suffered terrible trauma during the 1970s, for example, well, they would not have been sent overseas at all, but during the Troubles here in the UK. Now, although their experiences in the armed forces may differ, what our veterans do share is a debt of gratitude from all of us for their courage, their sacrifice, and because of their defence of the democratic freedoms that we value so much. We know that for most veterans, integrating back into civilian life after completing their service is relatively straightforward. For others, though, this isn't the case. Some ex-service personnel face challenges that, in trying to adjust to life following their discharge from service, it's important that they have all the support and the assistance they need to participate fully in our society. The valuable skills and experience our military veterans gain during their service make them an asset to Scotland, and I am very grateful to have the opportunity to recognise this during today's debate. Now, I strongly support the Scottish Government's commitment to improving the lives of Armed Forces veterans and their families through the powers of this Parliament. The Cabinet Secretary has highlighted the progress made since Eric Fraser was appointed last June as Scotland's first Veterans Commissioner. The Commissioner has indeed outlined an ambitious plan to deliver better outcomes for those who have served in our armed forces, and I look forward to further progress in addressing some of the challenges facing our veterans, especially concerning housing, health and employability opportunities, which, of course, other speakers have already mentioned. I was delighted that the Cabinet Secretary chose to launch the Commissioner's report, Transition in Scotland, at the Scottish Fire and Rescue College in Cambuslang. Before I became an MSP, I worked for Strathclyde Fire Brigade for some 10 years, and I am pleased to see that Scotland's Fire and Rescue Service continues to employ veterans in a number of different roles. Strathclyde Fire and Rescue is one of the many bodies to sign up in support of the Armed Forces Corporate Covenant, which offers a commitment to support the armed forces community, as well as recognising their contribution to society. Indeed, during the launch of the Commissioner's report last month, the Cabinet Secretary highlighted the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service as being an excellent model of an employer that is actively supportive of veterans. I'd also like to echo the words of Alistair Hay, the Chief Officer for Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, who said that former Armed Forces personnel bring outstanding benefits to their employers and display qualities of integrity, professionalism and leadership. Indeed, during my time as an employee of Strathclyde Fire Brigade, I met a number of veterans who had moved into working for Strathclyde Fire Brigade at that time, and all of them were extremely professional, and all of them were an asset to the organisation. It is with regret, therefore, that despite benefiting from these valuable skills, a number of veterans continue to experience barriers to finding employment after their service ends. Employability among service leavers is a key concern raised in the Veteran Commissioner's recent report. In his report, he highlights research by Poppy Scotland, which suggests that levels of unemployment among the ex-service community in Scotland are worryingly high. This is particularly evident for early service leavers, as Mary Fee highlighted earlier, with figures suggesting that only 52% of early service leavers find employment within 6 months of leaving, compared with 85% of those who have served longer. Research commissioned by the Royal British Legion in 2011 found that inability to secure alternative employment is one of the key reasons why some veterans are unable to successfully adjust to civilian life. The study also highlighted the importance of a range of other factors, including mental health issues, limited social networks, financial difficulties and lack of awareness of available support. A 2012 report by Citizens Advice Scotland entitled Civvy Street, the New Front Line, also looked at evidence suggesting that some veterans are restricted by a lack of awareness of available support services. Furthermore, the report suggested that despite the availability of an array of support organisations, a number of service leavers do not seek help due to a sense of pride and a desire to remain independent. It is estimated that there are upwards of 400,000 ex-service men and women living in Scotland today, with over 50 veterans' organisations and charities dedicated to supporting them. Now, I have seen firsthand some of the excellent work taking place all over the country in support of Scotland's veterans, and like other members, I have also visited Erskine on a number of occasions, and I think it is an excellent organisation that does really first-class work. Presiding Officer, I should, of course, maybe declare an interest at this point in that I am an honorary patron of Armed Forces Legal Action, known as AFLA. The group was founded in 2013 by East Renfrewshire-based solicitor and RAF officer Alan Steele in order to offer discounted legal services to serving and former members of the Armed Forces. AFLA has cross-party support and is backed by a number of other MSPs who are honorary patrons, including Willie Rennie, who is not here today, but Ken McIntosh and Jackson Carlo, who both are. Its founder, Alan Steele, will be known to many in the Chamber. Alan and his wife, Lindsay, have been working tirelessly to grow AFLA and build a network of law firms in Scotland and across the UK to deliver better services for the armed forces community. I understand that AFLA now has over 100 partner law firms signed up to the initiative, with ambitious plans for further expansion abroad to a number of countries in the Commonwealth. Although a relatively new initiative, the success of AFLA so far is testament to the high esteem in which our servicemen and women are held, and I look forward to it going from strength to strength in the years ahead. One of the curious things I think about the establishment of this initiative is that there cannot be a year that passes without new veterans initiatives being established, and yet we always think that everything is covered, but there's always room for more support in new areas, and so I'm delighted that that particular new initiative is doing so well. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, while it's clear that there's a wide range of support available to ex-servicemen and women, a key challenge is removing the barriers that prevent veterans and their dependents from accessing these services. The Scottish Government has made significant progress in addressing these issues. However, it's clear from the Commissioner's report that we can do even more to help people leaving the military. I'm encouraged by the Cabinet Secretary's undertaking to work with key stakeholders in order to take these recommendations forward. Our armed forces personnel sacrifice so much for us. It's only right that we honour their service by supporting veterans.
Many thanks. I now call on David Stewart to be followed by Christine Graham.
Presiding Officer. A little more than 5 short years ago, here in this very Parliament, I opened the members' debate raising concerns about the possible closure of RAF Kinloss. The campaign, as MSPs will be aware, was cross-party and supported by all the then party leaders, Alex Salmond, Annabel Goldie, Tavish Scott and Ian Gray. I argued then that armed forces personnel have a social covenant with our country at times of peace and at war. And at times of conflict, I personally remember the famous lines from John Maxwell Edmonds, repeated every Remembrance Sunday across the length and breadth of Scotland. When you go home, tell them of us and say, for their tomorrow, we gave our today. The social covenant was best illustrated to me 23 years ago, when the American naval base in Dunoon was closed, with a loss of over 1,500 American personnel. The local community rallied round and set up a dynamic economic community committee, supported by the EU and government funding, to diversify the economy and provide new jobs. The UK government set up the Armed Forces Covenant in May 2011, which put the full financial muscle to this philosophical principle. Now, Presiding Officer, my interest in this debate about veterans, probably like most other members of the Parliament today, is personal. My father did his national service with the RAF as a fresh-faced 18-year-old at Kinloss nearly 70 years ago. In my last year of school, the Highlands, like Jackson Carlow, I seriously thought about joining the RAF, but it never came to fruition. Perhaps Mr Carlow and I should set up a support group. on the basis that we're not very good at hitting targets as well. But what I will promise today, Presiding Officer, is that I will join the cross-party group on veterans. I think it sounds like an excellent group, and it's one I personally would be very happy to put my time into. However, Presiding Officer, there was a positive ring to this. During my time in Westminster from 1997, I seized the opportunity to serve for the RAF for 2 terms as part of the Armed Forces Parliamentary Scheme. And just when I'm on my feet, Presiding Officer, you may know in my time in the corporate body, I felt very strongly that this Parliament should be actively involved with the Armed Forces Parliamentary Scheme, and I would certainly endorse my colleagues like Liam Chalmers, who's in the back of the chamber today, to perhaps pursue this with the Scottish Parliament, because I do believe that parliamentarians here could be part of a UK-wide scheme which gives lots of experience to parliamentarians. In my own case, I had placements.
Brian.
Thank you for giving away. And also just to mention that in the previous debate, we had got cross-party support for just such an initiative. And I spoke to the MP who's in charge of that scheme. And we are taking that forward, either with the parliamentary corporate body or separately. We'll take it forward. I think it's a very useful scheme. Although it was suggested to me it should be a scheme in Scotland, which I hadn't thought of before, rather than one with the UK. Although we're looking at both options just now.
Just to say, Presiding Officer, I support what the Cabinet Secretary said. My own experience of the scheme was it was extremely successful. I would certainly endorse either model. The key thing is that we get parliamentarians to have first-hand experience of the armed forces across Scotland. So I would certainly support that initiative. Just to say very briefly before I move on to the substantive aspects, Presiding Officer, that during my two terms I had experience at RAF Kinloss and Lossiemouth, as well as a very memorable week in Basra in Iraq, which I can perhaps bore members at great length at another time on. But during that two terms, I flew in a Tornado fast jet, a Nimrod maritime aircraft, and a Sea King search and rescue helicopter. And perhaps just one example, Presiding Officer, since we've a little bit of time. My last day with the RAF, the Sea King that I was involved in had an emergency to tend to at Glencoe. And I remember distinctly flying a few hundred feet above Loch Ness on the way to Glencoe and watched and observed firsthand the bravery, the expertise and professionalism of the pilots and the winch crew as they saved the life of a young Swiss mountaineer who had fallen off the mountain and had severe facial injuries in the mountain accident. Now, my experience, I do appreciate, Presiding Officer, was a very brief snapshot, but it has given me tremendous admiration for the armed forces and veterans. It should always be remembered, of course, that people do not stay in the armed forces forever. However, our responsibility to these people who have served our country does not stop when they leave the services. The covenant we make with them and those in service community does not stop when they rejoin civilian life. It's also important to bear in mind that we, as a country, have invested a great deal of money in training our service men and women, and whilst we have a duty to ensure they are looked after, we also have a duty to ensure that this investment in skills and training is not lost to society. That's just one reason why it's important we provide a high-quality transition from the services to civilian life. Now, the unfortunate picture portrayed by some in the media is of dysfunctional ex-servicemen and women struggling to cope with meaningless civilian life. Nothing can be further from the truth. Success, however, makes the headlines, but for the vast majority of veterans, the step back into civilian life is painless and successful. Indeed, the more typical reality is like a constituent of mine from Inverness, who proudly served with the Scots Guards, and like most of his fellow guardsmen, he took every opportunity for training and education that the Army offered. Now, having left the Army, he's currently out on a successful career with a civil engineering company who value the special skills that a service veteran can bring. Of course, as we've heard from other members this afternoon, some veterans do find transition difficult and need our assistance. Help may be needed with finding a home or a job or with a variety of health problems. Where help is needed, it must be given and given very quickly. And we know from the valuable work carried out by the Scottish Veterans Commissioner, Eric Fraser, that around 1,800 men and women complete their military service and settle in Scotland each year. The Commissioner has been charged by the Scottish Government to investigate how veterans cope with transition, using the excellent Forces in Mind Trust as a guide. And currently in Scotland, there are around 400,000 veterans, and it's the Scottish Government's responsibility that they have adequate and suitable housing, health and social care, education, skills and training to readjust to civilian life. A key aspect of this is ensuring that veterans are not socially excluded and receive most appropriate support, guidance and assistance both during transition and the many years thereafter. Now, I'm glad, Presiding Officer, that the Scottish Government has established the Scottish Veterans Fund to support groups and organisations that provide assistance to Scotland's ex-service personnel, their families and their dependents. And this is a Minister's collaboration with Veterans Scotland. It will focus on a new or innovative approach to veterans' issues and will seek to develop areas and activities that are not currently funded by either the Scottish Government or the Ministry of Defence. However, the Commission's report clearly shows that veterans need a lot more support, especially in terms of housing, health and social care. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, because I'm conscious of time, I really welcome this debate we've had this afternoon, which highlights the special skills that veterans bring to the workplace and society at large. Let's not forget that we owe veterans through the social covenant, leaving the service is not an end of a meaningful career, but a transition to a new one, where a veteran's considerable skills continue to be utilised for the benefit of society as a whole. Thank you.
And thank you very much. I now call on Christine Graham to be followed by Bruce Crawford.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I recognise the point that Dave Stewart makes, that for many, leaving the armed forces for civilian life transition is successful, but it's for those leaving the armed forces who find it very difficult that I think we must particularly focus in adapting to civilian life. And I very much agree with Jackson Carlaw's speech when he says they've been in a structured situation. Some have come from chaotic lives to a structured situation, and then that all stops when they're discharged, and we must support them. Because for some, the struggle takes their lives to extremes of alcoholism, drugs, and the breakdown of their relationships. There will be veterans who are homeless on the streets of Scotland, and there are certainly veterans in our prisons. And regrettably, they are there many for crimes of violence connected to alcohol. Now, these are failures of society for these individuals. And they're not there only because of post-traumatic stress disorder that may play part. Some, it may be simply the awfulness of adjusting from an organised, structured army or naval or whatever life to civilian life. And it's of particular interest to me because of my constituency, where the Scottish Borders has a long history of parties and families joining the regiments over the decades, indeed the centuries. And indeed, I have Glencorse Barracks located in my Midlothian part of the constituency. So I therefore commend Lothian's Veterans Centre, because we were referred to earlier by Jackson Carlaw about how to access the various help that you might need for quite simple things like getting a GP and so on. Well, Lothian Veterans Centre, located in Dalkeith, provides ex-service personnel and their families with support, and it's face-to-face support in matters of health and well-being, housing, employment and support. And something that nobody has mentioned, comradeship and remembrance, because there will be people who are grieving, who have been discharged, grieving for injured comrades or comrades who did not return. In the Borders, Veterans Scotland has a dedicated and very comprehensive website, again, specifically dealing with these issues. It's headed Civilian Life in the Scottish Borders. This signposts veterans and their families to what is available to them and what priorities they may be given. For example, in housing, they're directed to the low-cost initiative for first-time buyers and to the various charitable organisations that specifically do housing for Scottish veterans. In health, a simple matter about how to locate a GP in your area and how to be on their panel. In employment, the Career Transition Partnership is simple things. How to write a CV, how to research the job market, how to learn interview skills. Issues which will not have arisen for them in a long time when in service. But on the employment issue, I want to turn to an initiative by Persimmon Homes under the banner Combat to Construction, which quite impressed me. Actually, I was there to see about a bus shelter, but things developed. This is an initiative, I'll tell you about that later when Dave Stewart tells us about his flight experiences. For veterans in England, this is a two-year apprenticeship scheme leading to a level two VQ after those 2 years, usually as joiners or bricklayers. The pay rate while in apprenticeship is £8 an hour. Now, in England, close to 100 ex-forces personnel have joined that company since September 2014 on that two-year apprenticeship framework, leading, as I said, to that level in wood or trowel occupations. Now, this is fully supported by the CITB and the Skills Funding Agency. It's called Combat to Construction, a nippy little term. To engage a Combat to Construction trainee in Scotland to train as a joiner or bricklayer would currently entail them having to enrol on a four-year apprenticeship, leading to a level three SVQ. The four-year duration, according to this company, does not work for two reasons. First, it's not commercially viable for the company, but actually, more importantly, it's not attractive for ex-forces personnel who do not want 4 years of further training. The company is exploring alternatives for Scotland, such as a commercial training programme with no SFA funding and therefore no Scottish Building Apprenticeship and Training Council involvement. But this would result in a lesser qualification that wouldn't be transferable or recognised outside Persimmon itself. Alternatively, the potential for a two-year timber frame erection qualification to level two is being investigated. Why am I going to this in detail? Because it seems to me like a really good idea that we could take from England. I've got no problem with good ideas from England. Cabinet Secretary, ex-service personnel are used to taking orders when they're in service, and in the trade, they're used to taking instructions. They're used to being outdoor work, and they are fit. So while I accept, of course, there have to be rules regarding apprenticeships and national qualifications, it does seem that the government could be looking at some flexibility which might be possible for those suitable and returning from service, where perhaps their training there could contribute towards that qualification. And I noted, Cabinet Secretary, your comments on apprenticeships at the beginning. I know I've kind of pounced this on you, that's the way to do it, but I hope you will, in fact, look into it. Now, finally, I must commend Poppy Scotland. And I'm going to do this because they financially supported my constituent, Kareen Boyd-Russell, whose son, Paul McGuigan, was shot and murdered in 2009, within 24 hours of arriving in Iraq as a security guard for G4S. He was shot by a fellow ex-serviceman. Now, there is an ongoing inquest, so I must constrain my comments, except to say, through liaising with my office, I think Poppy Scotland were absolutely wonderful, providing funding for accommodation for this poor laddie's mother so that she could go and attend at least the early stages of the inquest, which otherwise was way beyond her means. I've put that on the record because sometimes people don't know the other things that Poppy Scotland does, way beyond the selling of the poppies and where that money goes. In conclusion, I'm very much heartened by the tone and content of this debate because, for me, it shows the Parliament has other personalities quite different from the rather raucous hostility at First Minister's questions. And in support, we do this in support, I hope, in recognition of the value of our armed forces and veterans. And I hope at the end of the vote tonight, we speak as one voice.
Many thanks. And now call on Bruce Crawford to be followed by Jane Baxter.
Thank you, President Officer. You know, I'm really enjoying the election campaign. I'm enjoying being out there. There's a lot of cut and thrust, obviously, and it can sometimes get a bit heated. But it's great also to come into Parliament like this today and get real mature discussion around a really serious issue. And I think everyone's treated it so far on that basis. President Officer, I'm glad I'm taking part in this important debate. But forgive me if at the beginning I indulge myself in just a little bit of nostalgia. I can't quite go back as far as Jackson Carlow and the Sopwith Camel. But I do know that I'd probably miss the targets as well, because I think my eyesight are as difficult as yours, Jackson. But I do recall well the early days following the election of the SNP and minority government in 2007. Been pleased to be unexpectedly given the role in government as liaison with the MOD as part of my job as Minister for Parliament. And it was in that role I attended the first meeting between the Scottish Government and the tri-service heads of the armed forces in Scotland. And I recall well the impact that the former First Minister's words had on how they felt. He told the tri-service heads of the armed forces in Scotland that they made up the very strong threads that made up the very tartan of Scotland. And the former First Minister went on to say that he wanted the service heads to challenge the SNP government to produce the best possible package of support for Scotland's veterans. It was a message, frankly, that the service heads took up incredibly enthusiastically. But just as importantly, so did the ministers, and at that time it was Stuart Maxwell, who did a great job at that time, and the civil servants, who I know some are here today supporting the minister, who are responsible for the delivery of the policies. The results were, I think, as Jackson alluded to earlier, I think we've got probably the best package of support for veterans anywhere on these islands. Now, that's not to say that services can't be improved, as others have said already, whether that's in the areas of housing, health, employability, well-being, information coordination, all of the issues taken on in the very constructive report put together by the Scottish Commissioner called Transition Scotland, and others have outlined that. However, I do believe strongly that the right person to be leading this work and delivering the required improvements is Keith Brown, the Cabinet Secretary himself. The Cabinet Secretary is highly respected in the veterans community, not only because he's a veteran himself, but because he's shown in his role in government that he's determined and committed to making a difference. Now, one particular area in the Transition Scotland report I want to pick up on and quote from a little extensively, if colleagues will forgive me, because actually I couldn't agree more with what the Commissioner said. And I think he, in the way he captured it in these three paragraphs, brings together exactly what the tone of this discussion should be about this afternoon, in the same way as Keith Brown talked about the need for everyone in society to recognise the contribution that service personnel can bring. Commissioner said, I've also become aware of the need to promote the strengths, skills and attributes of our service personnel with much more passion and determination. Too often these people are labelled either mad, bad or sad. I grave disservice to a talented and committed cohort who have the potential to make a considerable contribution to Scotland's economy, communities and society after they complete their military service, reinforcing the positive qualities of service leavers and challenging the negative perceptions is, I am convinced, the first step in changing attitudes, opening up employment opportunities and making it easier to make a good transition. I think that explains very well what we're about. I think the Commissioner captured it well. And I want to play my part today in promoting the strengths, skills and attributes of our service personnel. The story from my own family. One of my sons joined the RAF, which seems to be a common theme so far that's emerging around one of the services and round here this afternoon. And I hope he won't mind me saying this, because he's a big, strong man now. But at the time, just let's say, like most young men, he was a bit raw and a little naive about the world. Some people still say about that about me yet. I remember in the time leading up to his joining, reading about the RAF's core values, because I did have concerns about what he was letting himself in for. I hadn't really understood it all at that time, as much as I should have done. Mutual and self-respect, integrity, moral courage, honesty, responsibility, justice, physical courage, loyalty, commitment, teamwork, personal excellence, discipline, pride. Who could argue with these core values? I also recall well my heart bursting with pride as he made his transition from his initial training period onto life as a fully-fledged serviceman at a ceremony at RAF Halton. That young man was well on his way to embracing the core values of the RAF, core values that have served him well, very well indeed, as he made a successful transition from service life to civvy street. But of course, not all of our ex-service people make that successful transition. Many have their own lives, put their own lives on hand, their own lives in jeopardy as they've tried to help us all. We all owe them a huge debt for this. And when members of the armed forces return from conflict, hang up their uniforms and become a civvy, it can be a very difficult time for them. Most of them have no idea of the scale of the challenge that that can be, leaving behind their job, their friends, having to find accommodation, sorting paperwork to apply for benefits, as well as adjusting to a completely different way of life. These are all individual challenges, but when you put them all together, it can result in serious problems for some. So ensuring that every service leader has the skills, support and advice to complete this transition successfully is crucial, not only to the individual, but also to their family and wider society. And I know, again, from the first-hand example of my son, the incredible training and skills he was provided with during that time. And that's what made me think also of the page 20 of the Commissioner's report, where he refers to the benefit that young service leavers might be able to get from being part of Opportunities for All, because obviously they may have missed out on that opportunity the first time round because they decided on a military career. And the recommendation goes on to say the Scottish Government should consider introducing flexibility to relax age restrictions, extend the eligibility for a criteria within the Opportunities for All Early Service Leavers programme. I think that's quite a good idea, Cabinet Secretary, if you don't mind me saying so, and I'm sure it's something you'll be looking at very closely. In conclusion, at my constituency, we are very lucky to have ASAP, the Armed Services Advice Project, which specifically provides focused advice and information to the Armed Forces community. ASAP is part of the local Citizen Advice Bureau, and it's run by Ali Gemmell, who's a veteran himself. And Ali and his colleagues have the ability to help those struggling with the massive life changes they're facing. And today, I'd like to thank people like Ali and others working for Poppy Scotland or whatever of the many, many ex-servicemen and women's charities that exist in Scotland. They have given that extra bit of help to the people when they need it most. So thank you. Thank you. You do an invaluable job.
Many thanks. Now call on Jean Baxter to be followed by Joan McAlpine.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should perhaps begin by saying that I can't share with you today any tales of my life in uniform. Sadly, I never even made it into the Brownies or the Girl Guides. But it is a privilege, nevertheless, to be able to speak in today's debate, and to have the opportunity to pay tribute to and express my gratitude to all those who have served and fought to protect our country and the freedoms which we take for granted. We have recently commemorated Gallipoli 100 and Anzac Day, where people across the country attended services to remember those who gave their lives in some of the fiercest fighting which took place during the Great War. We are, of course, in the midst of 4 years of commemoration, remembering the centenary years of the Great War and all of those who fought in that war. However, Presiding Officer, as the recent report published by the Scottish Veterans Commissioner shows, the challenges that our service personnel face today in transitioning to civilian life are still very real and significant. Indeed, it could be argued that with the growing pressures on our local services and with a very real housing crisis affecting all of Scotland's citizens, that transition is being made even more difficult for our service personnel. As a Fife councillor, I was inundated with casework from constituents who had a desperate need for housing or whose housing was unsuitable. As an MSP, I still find that housing is one of the biggest issues for my constituents, and I know that my colleagues will agree that a large part of their casework focuses on the housing needs of their constituents. For our veterans, this crisis provides an additional problem. As the report by the Scottish Veterans Commissioner highlights, there is a unique difficulty for veterans and their families who've had their housing needs catered for when they're faced with a situation where they have to find a long-term home for themselves and perhaps their families. Given the shortages in affordable, social and council housing, there's always a very real possibility that our service personnel transitioning to civilian life will be left homeless, and I do not believe that that's an acceptable situation. As a Parliament, we accept that in Scotland we need to build more affordable homes, and that governments of all colours have failed to adequately address this problem in the past. In Fife, the Labour-led Council has taken strategic decisions to address this problem with a programme to build 2,700 homes, but we need a national house-building strategy to end our housing crisis. As a Fife councillor, I had the privilege of working with Councillor Charles Haffey, a Royal Navy veteran who saw active duty in the Falklands War and who is Fife's Armed Forces champion. As a Fife MSP, I continue to work with Charles and to be immensely proud of the work which is done by Labour-led Fife Council to support veterans. Fife truly has led the way in improving engagement with and support to the Armed Forces community. In particular, extensive work has been undertaken to recognise and put in place the support measures that our veterans need to find employment and to set up a new life out with the Armed Forces. Fife Council and its partners in the public sector and a number of volunteer organisations have worked together closely to ensure that our veterans have access to the support structures and services that will enable them to use their unique skills and talents to achieve their full potential. This is all brought together on the Council's website on the Fife Firm Base pages, and I also know that Councillor Haffey takes his role very seriously and is conscientious in his efforts to build effective partnership working and networks to support Armed Forces personnel and veterans and, of course, their families. The report also points out that the future for many veterans is not always filled with such optimism. Indeed, challenges highlighted in the report such as social isolation, mental health problems, disability and lack of basic skills can have a devastating effect on our veterans' ability to reintegrate into and thrive in civilian society. For our veterans returning to civilian life with a mental or physical disability, we must do more. We know that improvement is needed in our mental health services and that we must make it easier for everyone to access these services. We must also do more to tackle the stigma of mental health and to raise awareness of these conditions in our communities. It is particularly important that our veterans can access these services and get help quickly, as while we know that mental health conditions are not significantly higher among our veterans, their illnesses tend to be more complex and severe. For our veterans suffering with physical disabilities, we must again ensure that we are doing everything possible to remove the barriers to them living full and active lives. In particular, we have a duty to ensure that our veterans are receiving the social care and additional support that they need without being financially burdened by the costs. We have a special duty and responsibility to care for and support those who have been injured while serving this country, and too often it seems that this is not happening. Just this week, for example, I was contacted by Mr. Smith, a constituent of mine from Rosyth, who has asked me to share his case with the Chamber. Mr. Smith, who served in Northern Ireland, was injured in one of his tours of duty and in later years subsequently lost his leg. However, despite fighting to receive the war pension which he feels he is entitled to and working with a number of organisations who have been helping and supporting him, Mr. Smith has been told that the MOD have lost the paperwork and relating to his case and cannot therefore give him the financial support he needs. We all know this is not good enough and that veterans like Mr Smith should not become victims of system failure but should be treated with the dignity and respect they are entitled to. Presiding Officer, as I stated before, I am immensely grateful for the contribution of our veterans. I am also optimistic that in Scotland it is becoming easier for our veterans to reintegrate and play a full and active part in civilian life. I have highlighted some of the things that we are doing well and areas where I believe we could do more. We need to make it easier for all stakeholders to work together to make sure we get it right for the members of our veteran community and their families. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now call on Joan McAlpine to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too welcome this debate and my opportunity to participate in praising the veterans' contribution to Scotland, and in particular welcoming the first report of our Veterans Commissioner. I think that the report certainly vindicates the appointment of a Commissioner, and that decision is one of a range of initiatives for veterans by the Scottish Government, which have attracted cross-party support, and particularly the government's support for the Scottish Veterans Fund, which has distributed £700,000 to relevant charities around Scotland. And I note that the contributions that other members have made, that the vast majority of veterans go on to make a very positive contribution to the life in our country. And that's why a smooth transmission is so important, which is what the Commissioner has concentrated on in his report. And obviously anything that we can do to ease transmission from service life to civilian life is very, very important. However, sometimes, obviously, if that transmission goes wrong, if the support's not there, that's when problems develop further down the line, sometimes many years down the line. So that's why today I'm going to concentrate on mental health issues faced by a minority of veterans, which can develop long after their period of service is concluded. Research published in The Lancet has found that those personnel who served in combat roles in Iraq and Afghanistan are far more likely to suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder and mental health issues than others. And those in combat roles were, of course, disproportionately represented in Scottish life because of, in many ways, the strength and expertise of Scottish infantry units. There's concern because of this that in the next 15 years might deliver a potential mental health time bomb in terms of rapidly increasing numbers of veterans seeking support for post-traumatic stress disorder type mental health issues. And statistics suggest that on average it takes 13 years from the first onset of symptoms for a veteran to reach out for advice and support and professional treatment. And of course next year marks 13 years since the beginning of the Iraq War. I appreciate that the Commissioner on page 29 of his report does talk about the mental health services that are provided, and indeed he praises them and the work that's been done. And he singles out two particular charities, third sector charities, which are supported by the Scottish Government for praise. One is Combat Stress, which provides post-traumatic stress disorder to veterans, and is a joint initiative with the NHS, which is funded to the tune of £1.2 million a year. And he also singles out Veterans First Point, which was created in 2009 in partnership with NHS Lothian to deliver a range of support, including clinical support. And again, I welcome the £640,000 given to it by the Scottish Government. Dr Lucy Abraham, who's the lead clinician, says that a key part of the success of Veterans First Point is that peer support workers work closely with the psychotherapy team. And previous to the service being established, veterans could be deterred by some of the complicated referral routes and the stigma around mental health. So it's a model of good practice, and I'm very pleased to see that it's being rolled out to other health board areas in Scotland using money made available from fines levied on the banks following the LIBOR scandal. The funding apparently is worth £2.5 million over 2 years, and I think that's probably something quite appropriate that people who have served their country in such an exemplary way are funded by fines on organisations that perhaps have not. There's considerable need for such support on the Veterans First Point model in my own area of the south of Scotland, although we also have examples of good practice, such as the charity First Base in Dumfries, which works with veterans experiencing difficulties across the region. And I should say that the Nithsdale area, which includes the town of Dumfries, has one of the highest concentrations of veterans in Scotland. The First Base project was established in 2010 and has worked with 150 clients with an age range of between 20 and 80. And when the project was first launched, the waiting time for a veteran to receive support for PTSD type systems from the local mental health team was around 9 months. Now, to address this problem, First Base came up with an innovative model of its own. It reached an agreement whereby they raised £5,000 to fund half a day a week's work of, from a young psychotherapist in the local NHS. And after a year, NHS Dumfries and Galloway took over the funding of the service. However, the partnership became a victim of its own success. Word spread of the excellent and effective treatment that many local veterans had received, and the waiting list has once again grown. So First Base have asked if they can have another half day of the psychotherapist's time, but unfortunately that's not possible because pressure of work means that his colleagues would need to backfill for him more than they do already, and that's just not possible. Now, it might seem obvious that the solution here is for the LIBOR cash being channelled through the Veterans First Point rollout to assist in Dumfries and Galloway. However, the region's Director of Psychology Services says that the short-term nature of the funding available through this grant is problematic. The Minister may be aware that recruiting NHS doctors in rural areas is challenging in itself, and often the number of consultant vacancies is very high. So recruiting someone for a short-term post is obviously going to be even more challenging. So it's been put to me from within the NHS that a long-term solution is needed. And it's also been put to me that a decentralised model would be more appropriate for a rural area like Dumfries and Galloway, more appropriate than, say, the Edinburgh model, where you've got a drop-in and you've got a kind of centre of excellence. For example, it's been suggested that perhaps if we were able to recruit a psychotherapist, that person could travel around the region offering treatment as close to home as possible. Now, I know that the Veterans Minister has a meeting soon with First Base, and I'm happy to raise this issue in advance, and forewarned is always forearmed. But I know that he will do everything that he can to help because, you know, as the Commissioner has said in his report, actually the services that we're getting in place, and particularly the collaboration between third sector and government, is working very well. So I will also appreciate anything that the Cabinet Secretary can do to help when he meets First Base. So in conclusion, it's been said already. I know I am aware that I've concentrated on some of the challenges facing veterans, but I am very, very well aware of the contribution that they make, and I'm delighted to have been able to contribute to the debate today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I now call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Mike McKenzie.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And, like others, I very much welcome this debate, notably the very constructive and consensual tone that's characterised the contributions from every member so far. A little like James Baxter, I can boast no personal pedigree in the uniformed services, although I did manage 2 years in the Cubs and 2 years in the Army Cadets, so that was more an excuse to play football and get sweets from the tuck shop. I took part in a similar debate in this chamber just over a year ago, and I'm delighted that we have a further opportunity to consider issues relating to veterans, and in this instance, the very considerable positive contribution they can and do make to this country. In the debate last year, along with others, I confess I raised questions about the creation of the Veterans Commissioner. At the time, there were certainly concerns, including even within the veterans community itself, that resources might be better deployed by increasing funding to organisations already providing valuable support and advice to veterans. We are, however, well beyond that debate now, and I am happy to pay tribute to the work that Eric Fraser does generally since his appointment last August, but also for the very measured and insightful report he's produced into the issue of transition out of the armed forces for those settling in Scotland. We all recognise that the transition can present serious challenges for certain individuals and their families, but I think the Commissioner has helpfully identified a number of very practical measures that can be taken that would deliver real improvements, improvements that will help service personnel and their families, but also secure benefits for our wider society and indeed our economy. Poppy Scotland and the Royal British Legion, as the Labour Amendment points out, have identified other areas where more targeted help might be provided, and I think those are certainly worthy of full and detailed consideration, and I welcome the confirmation from Keith Brown that this is currently happening. In Scotland, every year around 1,800 men and women complete their military service and settle with their families in communities right across the country. This transition from the armed services into civilian life invariably involves leaving behind not simply a job, but also a home and a community, a way of life, in fact. It's worth acknowledging, as the Commissioner does, that most, like Bruce Crawford's son, cope with this change remarkably well, demonstrating that amongst the many skills that veterans have is the ability to adapt and deal with a range of fundamental life-changing experiences that few of us have ever had to endure. Where this works well, not only does the transition see employment and a home secured, but also a strong and supportive social network established, enabling each veteran and their family to become net contributors to society over the longer term. As the motion rightly identifies, those leaving the armed services do so more often than not with good training and skills, as well as a sense of duty and discipline, all of which should make them attractive propositions for potential employers across a range of different fields. This has not gone unnoticed, of course. I know from discussions with those in the oil and gas sector, for example, that they have for some time now identified former service personnel as ideal candidates to fill many of the much publicised skills gaps and vacancies in that sector. Now, what effect the current downturn in the oil price will have on those opportunities for veterans is perhaps uncertain, but the natural fit seems one that is set to continue to be of mutual benefit. This example also illustrates the benefit, indeed the necessity, of good collaborative working between different stakeholders. Oil and Gas UK and OPITO have worked closely with the enterprise agencies and veterans groups to help identify and open up these opportunities. Without such a joined-up approach, it's difficult to see how much could have been achieved on behalf of those transitioning back into civilian life. And this focus on collaboration is a theme in Eric Fraser's report. He rightly praises, for example, the Glasgow Veterans Employment Programme run by Glasgow's Helping Heroes in the City Council. Under the scheme, a wage subsidy is paid to employers taking on ex-servicemen and women aged between 25 and 49 who would otherwise not qualify for employment support. This allows existing skills to be adapted to provide a better fit with the civilian jobs market. The benefits of this, on top of delivering employment for veterans, are estimated to be in the region of £17 million through both increased economic activity but also reduced benefit costs. I was also interested to hear about the project run by Forth Valley Chamber of Commerce called Veterans into New Employment, an initiative with the backing of the MOD, Poppy Scotland and others that recognises the transferable skills which many service leaders have that can be applied to running their own businesses. Turning, if I may, to the needs of younger service leaders, leavers, the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that Mr Fraser has identified a number of improvements that can and should be made to support this particular group. Specifically, there is the call for the Scottish Government to, quote, consider introducing a flexibility to relax the age restrictions, extending the eligibility criteria for opportunities for all for early service leavers. Those entering the services at an early age may not have had the chance to improve their educational qualifications during their short military service, but find that when they leave, they are already too old to benefit from opportunities for all. This would seem straightforward to fix, and like Bruce Crawford, I very much hope that the Cabinet Secretary and his officials could find a way to resolve this in the near future. Certainly.
Cabinet Secretary.
Liam MacArthur for taking intervention. Just to point out that it is possible up to now, the flexibility is there up till age 24. So, for example, somebody joined the services at 18 and a 3-year short service engagement would be eligible for some years to take up those opportunities. But I would undertake, both in relation to the point you make and Bruce Crawford, to look at it further.
Liam MacArthur.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that intervention. Eric Fraser also then goes on to call for the Scottish Government and Skills Development Scotland to consider actively promoting modern apprenticeships to early service leavers and to their potential employers. And while it might be slightly surprising this hasn't happened to date, I think Keith Brown made a fairly accurate assessment of the situation. But I welcome his commitment to look at what more can be done to make this information more widely available. Deputy Presiding Officer, as I've said, many leaving the service do so very successfully thanks to a greater or lesser extent to the support they receive from a wide range of agencies. It is no secret, however, that some do struggle, and in this context I wish to concentrate my concluding remarks, like Joe McAlpine, on the issue of mental health, an absolute priority for me personally and for the Liberal Democrats more generally. The stigma surrounding mental health is a problem for our society as a whole. But for those with a background in the services, this can often be markedly worse for the reasons I think highlighted by Stuart Maxwell in his contribution. I'm delighted, therefore, that Liberal Democrats have pledged an extra £10 million to help support servicemen and women suffering from mental health problems. This more than doubles the money currently available to help veterans overcome problems such as post-traumatic stress disorder, and is part of a £3.5 billion investment in improving mental health provision from which Scotland would benefit significantly. It would also help provide support for alcohol and drug misuse and dual diagnosis of substance misuse and mental health problems. It would allow for investment in services such as community-based therapy, short-stay hospital treatment and more targeted employment support to help get people back into work. We ask our armed forces to put their lives on the line for our country. It is only right that as a country we provide them with the support they need thereafter to fulfil their potential and make the valuable contribution they and we wish to see them make. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary opened his, I thought, very well-judged remarks earlier by drawing attention to the genuine and firm cross-party consensus that exists on veterans' issues. He's absolutely right, and this, along with the insights of the Veterans Commissioner and the tireless work of Poppy Scotland, British Legion, Erskine, CAB and many, many others, give me confidence that we will see further improvements in the future, allowing veterans to make the positive contribution they and we wish to see them make. Thank you.
Thank you. I understand my colleague gave members up to 7 minutes for their speeches. I'm afraid I must ask members to keep to their 7 minutes. Mike McKenzie to be followed by Graham Day.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in this debate because it was my good fortune for an over 30 years of running a business of having the opportunity of employing and working with a number of Armed Forces veterans. And some of these were amongst the very best people I have ever worked with. All of them brought valuable qualities to our workforce. And part of that was a healthy and intelligent attitude to work. Part of that was an ability to fit in constructively with our team, and part of it was a loyalty to and a regard for the safety and well-being of other members of the team, something that's of crucial importance on building sites. And all of these qualities are important and have a valuable place in any workforce. But what was truly outstanding about the veterans I employed over the years, what was remarkable, was the self-discipline they brought to bear. They would always arrive in time for work with their boots polished. And I was never greatly concerned about the boots being polished, but I greatly admired the self-discipline that manifested itself in every aspect of their work. And along with this went pride in their work, the pride of a task well accomplished or a job well done. And from this in turn arose that sense of dignity, that quality that's been described as the dignity of labour. And it's an attitude that manifests itself in the belief that even the smallest and the seemingly unimportant task is worth doing well. And when quality is our aim, then this can only be truly delivered when we take this approach. The whole can only be greater than the sum of its parts when each part of our various labours is delivered with the care and the wish to deliver our respective parts well. And in the business context, this, for me anyway, is the basis of real, long-lasting and sustainable wealth creation. Presiding Officer, it was my experience that this sense of personal worth and dignity is a quality which, although it's not exclusive to armed forces veterans,
it's certainly more prevalent in veterans. And from this dignity, in my experience, springs a kind of unassuming self-confidence that's an all too rare quality. And it's an easy confidence which allows good and accurate communications. The veterans I worked with were always happy to come and tell you about problems and discuss them in honest and constructive terms. And this is something I found to be invaluable. And because any business that doesn't have this constructive dialogue and feedback loop with its employees denies itself the full opportunity of real and meaningful improvement in what it does. I must also say that when I employed tradesmen who have learned their trade in armed services, that they were not only the true masters of their craft, but they also had a can-do and problem-solving attitude that is equally valuable. Presiding Officer, I've dwelt on these qualities at some length because I'm aware that our veterans do not always enjoy such positive perceptions. Part of that seems to go hand in hand with the nature of the employment they undertake on our behalf. As a nation in Scotland, I think we have a healthy distaste for war, but it's unfortunate when this spills over into misguided perceptions affecting the individuals involved. It's been my experience that such negative perceptions just don't match the reality. So that's why I'm glad that our Cabinet Secretary, with responsibility for veterans, and the first of any UK nation to have that ministerial responsibility, is a veteran himself, and therefore understands the needs of veterans. That's why I'm glad that he's wasted no time in appointing Eric Fraser as the Veterans Commissioner, who is himself another veteran. And that's why I'm glad, in turn, that he has wasted no time in producing what I thought was a very insightful Transitions in Scotland report, which details a number of practical suggestions for improvement. Scotland has a good record of looking after our veterans, but there are, of course, improvements that can be made. And I think we need to be careful not to overstate the negative aspects of the challenges facing veterans. I'm pleased to share my very positive experiences of employing veterans in the hope that other employers will recognise the many good qualities that veterans bring to their work and the valuable contribution that they can make to any business and also to Scotland at large.
Thank you very much. I now call Graeme Day to be followed by Hans Alamalek.
Thank you very much. Presiding Officer, I very much welcome this opportunity to speak about the contribution of our veterans and note that whilst those who serve in the armed forces play a vital role in protecting our national security, the contribution that they can and do make to society does not end when they leave the services. Like others, I should perhaps declare an interest. My maternal grandfather rose to the rank of Major along the way winning the Military Cross in the Gordon Highlanders. I'm the nephew of a Pay Corps Staff Sergeant and the cousin of someone who reached the rank of Captain in the Royal Engineers. So this is a subject close to my heart, and I echo the comments of colleagues in welcoming the tone that's been struck in this debate. In recent months, two important reports on the support available for veterans as they transition to civilian life have been published. One was the follow-up to Poppy Scotland's 2009 research into the employment support needs of veterans, and the other was the transition in Scotland. The first report from the Veterans Commissioner, Eric Fraser, which was showcased at an event hosted by Alec Ferguson here in Parliament just a few short weeks ago. It's important to acknowledge, as Poppy Scotland's 6 years on, revisiting the employment support needs of veterans in Scotland report does, the developments that have taken place since that first piece of work was published in 2009. New resources dedicated to supporting veterans transitioning to civilian life have been introduced during the intervening period. We have made progress. We've seen a renewed political focus on meeting veterans' needs that has resulted in developments such as the establishment of a Minister for Veterans in Scotland and the UK-wide adoption of the Armed Forces Covenant. More recently, we've had the appointment of Eric Fraser, who's with us in the gallery today. There's been a growing understanding of veterans' transition and employment support needs, partly as a result of studies by Lord Ashcroft, the Forces in Mind Trust, the Royal British Legion in Poppy Scotland. And we've increased partnership working among support agencies and a range of new services for those that struggle with securing employment. And partnership working in a general sense is going to be critical going forward. I think it's important to acknowledge, as others have, that most veterans make a successful transition to civilian life. However, Poppy Scotland released some concerning veterans' employment data last year. And whilst the Veterans Commissioner has noted that these figures only come from the one source at the moment, whatever way you look at them, they do appear to demonstrate that whilst that progress has been made, we still have some way to go. In terms of specific areas where progress requires to be made, the Commissioner highlights that some employers see veterans, especially older service leavers, as aggressive, inflexible or difficult to manage. Mad, bad or sad, a phrase I think Eric Fraser himself referred to at the parliamentary event. And that's got to change. These people may often have fought in dangerous conditions. Just because they've had such experience does not mean that they cannot integrate back into civilian life or should not be fully supported to do so. Lord Ashcroft and the Forces and Mind Trust have recommended the adoption of personal development plans. These would provide a record of qualifications, training, education and achievements for all service personnel. And as I think Eric Fraser acknowledged, this is something the Cabinet Secretary has been advocating for quite some time. We need to make sure that employers and educational institutions understand the skills, experience and qualifications that service personnel have gained during their time in the military that can make them a real asset. I understand that work is ongoing in the latter case. For example, the Glasgow Caledonian University's Learning Partnership, which works with the Armed Forces, three colleges in the city, and Glasgow's Helping Heroes. The scheme is open to Armed Forces personnel who are nearing the end of their time in the military and considering a return to education to further develop their skills. Opportunities to study for qualifications at a number of levels are on offer. Applicants are invited to make a recognition of prior learning claims so that participants can tell the organisers about their previous learning, including the valuable knowledge gained through work and life experiences. More widely, further education colleges throughout Scotland offer upskilling programmes to early service leaders, and those leaving the armed forces can utilise their exit grants to pursue such courses. Whilst gaining employment is not a panacea, it can help to solve other problems such as securing housing or tackling self-esteem issues that someone may be suffering from. We should recognise that while some service personnel leave through choice, others have had no option, with some handed their P45 while on the front line, which is a disgrace. However, the Poppy Scotland report notes that for some veterans, it's not just the actual gaining employment that can assist in this way. For some, the social aspects of employment services are as important as the potential of getting a job. A number of veterans with employment support needs face a myriad of complex and interrelated social, employment and health challenges. It may be that getting assistance relating to the world of work may lead to veterans being directed to the required support for other parts of their lives. Twice last year, Presiding Officer, I spoke in the Chamber on the issue of veterans and highlighted the Houses for Heroes project in Carnoustie. I'm delighted to advise the Cabinet Secretary that the project, which he launched symbolically by beginning the demolition of the old folks' home, which was formerly on the site, is coming to fruition, with the construction of the five properties complete and tenancy discussions underway. The Commissioner very much highlighted in his report the need to ensure that those leaving the forces have information on housing options. As with education, it's important that the information provided to service leavers in Scotland is tailored to the Scottish system. The Scottish Government currently provides a Scottish housing guide for people leaving the armed forces and ex-service personnel, as well as multiple councils, including Angus, where service leavers can accrue housing points ahead of returning to civil life. Councils throughout the country providing their own leaflets and information packs. It is to Scotland's credit that outside of London, we have the most bed spaces dedicated for veterans organisations. Organisations providing this accommodation include the Scottish Veterans Residence, Houses for Heroes, Hague Housing and Erskine. Many of these groups were founded in the aftermath of World War I, and yet they are continuing to provide an invaluable service. All charities use the Common Housing Register, hosted by Veterans Scotland. This system, which makes use of a single database and a single application form, has been highlighted by York University for its impact on meeting an important need. It's also key when looking at this topic to remember that veterans' families may face difficulties in the move away from the forces. This will be a big change for all involved. And veterans' families may well need support too. For example, spouses who found it difficult to progress their own careers owing to moving frequently or being posted overseas. These people also have a lot to offer, and there is a need to ensure that their well-being is catered for as well. Presiding Officer, when our service personnel come to leave the forces, they will have done their bit for the country. In return, we must surely ensure that they can continue to have fulfilling lives, get a fair deal after they return to civilian life.
Many thanks, and I now call Hans Alamalik to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you very much and good afternoon, Presiding Officer. It is a pleasure for me to speak on this subject of making the most of our veterans' contribution to Scotland. As some of you will know, I have served in the Territorial Army for many years and managed to hit my own targets, you'd be pleased to know. I am also a board member on board of the Lowland Reserve Forces and the Cadet Association. I also have links with ABS, the Soldiers' Charity, formerly the Army Benevolent Fund, which helped over 750 soldier veterans and their families in Scotland last year alone. I have been made aware of the wide spectrum of support that is needed to help our former service men and women adapt to civil life, or civilian life as we know it in the parliamentary language. The public tends to be aware, very aware of military charities which deal with headline-grabbing issues, for example, mental health, wounded in action, and to a lesser degree, residential care areas. This is vital work which has a higher individual cost per case, but for comprehensive small numbers of veterans is important. When looking at the contribution of our veterans, we also need to acknowledge the large number of cases that need lower cost support, to consider the consequences and our veterans' needs in Scotland as civilians. For example, many ex-service personnel and their families and services have managed many aspects of their lives, and once they have left the service, many are trying to access housing, education, and employment, also applying for benefits for the first time in many years, and in some cases, in first time in their lives. Please note that, respectively, separately, talking about veterans and their families, as this is a very important part of our community. I would therefore like to acknowledge the work of the three service owned charities, the Royal Navy and Royal Marine Charity, ABS, the Soldiers' Charity, and the Royal Air Force Benevolent Fund, in quietly continuing to provide vital support to many veterans and their families in Scotland. Now I would like to move to what I feel is an injustice. In the Scottish Government's changing guidelines for social care, I fully support the Insult to Injury campaign run by Poppy Scotland and the Royal British Legion. It is unacceptable that injured veterans that have been awarded compensation should have most of it taken away to cover the costs of social care. I understand that social care services are under pressure due to, and it's not a political comment, but due to the SNP policy of the council tax freeze. But clawing back the money from injured veterans and other vulnerable people is deeply distasteful. I want to try and keep this as much as possible non-political, because I know that the issue itself is more important than politics. I also know personally friends, relatives, and constituents who have been in the armed forces and have come to harm. But what is more painful is to witness that harm, to see that there's not much an individual can do to support them, which means that rather than the veterans relying upon charities, they really need to rely upon the government, local or national or regional, but the governments need to fulfill that post. When a soldier signs on the dotted line, the soldier knows The serviceman knows, the servicewoman knows that when they put their mark on that piece of paper, they're volunteering to put their life on the line for their country. Now, yes, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Hanzala Malik for taking the intervention? And just to put the question to him, because around a third of local authorities don't claw back that money just now in Scotland. But if he feels as strongly as he does about that, and he's quite entitled to do as I do, wouldn't he think the best thing to do would be for that authority which overlooks pensions and benefits, i.e. the UK government, to simply say that this should be disregarded in terms of care costs? A simple way to do it.
Hanzala Malik, and I can reimburse your time.
That's very kind of you, presiding officer. You know, it's very easy to blame the other person. It's a deserved matter. We should be able to make those decisions ourselves. And we have in many cases. It's all about priorities. And I think to recognize the contribution that our servicemen and women make, to recognize that the support that they then need to have behind them is important. When a service person is serving overseas in the front line, they need to know that they have the support, the hearts and minds of the community behind them. So God forbidding if they come to any harm, or in fact their families, that there is someone there to pick up the pieces for them and support them. And I think that's very important. So I in fact would go further, and I would say in fact, I would go further by saying that the Scottish Government should examine the possibility of free transport, free public transport for our veterans. Because other than our pensioners, I think this is another group that deserve that type of contribution from our governments. I think recognizing the contribution our servicemen and women make is important. I know that you do recognize that. I take on board all the members I have spoken today. I genuinely believe that everyone feels just as passionately about this as I do. I'm not any special. But what I will say is that we need to show more for our men and women who actually put their lives on the floor, put their lives on the line. I'm quite happy to take the intervention.
Bruce Crawford.
Just would Hanzala accept that the Scottish Government already makes sure that there's free public transport for veterans who've been injured? And is he really suggesting that we should now extend that to 400,000 veterans who exist in Scotland, every single one of them?
Hanzala Malik.
Yes, I am. Why not? What's the big problem? I think that, you know, what I'm really saying is I'm not questioning your sentiment. I am making that absolutely clear. All I'm saying is that we need to be there for our community. We need to be there for our pensioners, and we need to be there for our veterans. And I think that there's no harm in looking at that. I'm not saying to you, start it tomorrow. I'm just asking the government to look at the possibility to do that. Of course.
Bruce Crawford.
Would you also extend that to all the ambulancemen, policemen and fire engine people or firefighters who've been involved in public service? Would that also involve them as well as veterans who weren't injured?
Hanzala Malik.
I think that you're picking at straws now. There's no need for that. I think that what I am saying is I am talking about those people who sign on the dotted line knowing the fact that they're putting their lives on the line. That's a huge difference from other walks of life. Please don't misunderstand what I'm trying to say. What I'm trying to say is let's respect our veterans to the hilt. And if it means giving them a free bus ride, why not? Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. And I now call on George Adam to be followed by Rob Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate and the tone the debate's had. You know, this is a very important debate for me, as we have quite a sizeable community of veterans within my constituency. The armed forces are an important part of life in Renfrewshire. The county has more Victoria Cross recipients from an area of its size than any other part of the Commonwealth. So, Presiding Officer, also personally, I can talk about it. I don't wish to sound like my colleague Stuart Stevenson when I talk about this, but there was a soldier from Kent called Stephen Gifford who, by marrying a Paisley woman called Margaret Clark in the early 1800s, if he had not married that woman, settled down in Paisley, my family may not have been from the town of Paisley. So that one incident
That one incident has changed history to that extent. He was also a member of a regiment called the 57th Regiment that fought in the Peninsular Wars. And there was a battle where 570 men, of which 422 died. So he seemed to be one of 148 survivors. So he was a very lucky individual as well. But this kind of background, this type of the very demography of my constituency, it's not unusual that we have such a connection with the armed forces. You know, it's only logical that many young men and women from our area join the services. And as a local MSP, I work with the local branch of Legion Scotland. In Paisley, it's called the Comrades Club. It doesn't have a number, which is very unusual within the Legion in itself. We just like to be different that way. But some of the cases that we work on are very difficult. We work with our welfare officer on many issues, and these include housing and very other challenging issues. And it's one of these things that if you make an appointment with the welfare officer on a Saturday or Sunday, you have to ensure you have a taxi to go home, because there's a good chance that you won't be able to drive at that stage. So that is one thing when you're working with the Royal British Legion. But, Presiding Officer, I would also like to add that some of the current issues that veterans are dealing with in my constituency, as has already been said, housing is one of the major issues for veterans. And it is quite good to see that in the report, the recommendation 1 and 2, they mentions the fact that housing is so important, because a number of charities in my area provide housing for the veterans. And a lot of this housing stock is getting quite old now and hasn't had the type of investment that it needs. And it's only right that we ensure we can work with these charities, but they also have to be responsible as well when it's dealing with the members from the armed forces and show some form of leadership with them as well. We have a strange situation where, you know, you can effectively take the man or woman out of the army, but you can't really take the discipline, army discipline, away from them. Because I had an individual who was having difficulty with one of the charities. He never had a boiler in his home and they were refusing to do it. And he kept sitting there because it's almost like an army structure within the charity. It was an officer, or had been an officer. And he was calling this gentleman sir when we were just trying to get him some basic needs for his actual property as well. And I think this is something I had to say to him, you know, we're here to represent you, make sure we can get what you need for your home. You're not in the army anymore. And I think that's part of the thing that we're dealing with when we're dealing with veterans, is that many of them have that mindset, that is, that they have spent a lot of their life within there. And we spend a lot of time discussing, which is only a handful of houses, and this should not be the case. But one of the other things that's quite shocking when you look at it is when you go to Armed Forces Days or Remembrance Sunday, the demography of the men and women who are marching or being part of the parades is changing. They are becoming younger because of some of the conflicts that we've had. And that in itself creates even further challenges when you're dealing with many of the issues with the reintegration to civilian life. There are many problems with young men and women coming away and out of the forces in their mid-20s after signing up in their teens. They have a sudden realisation that they have to pay their own bills. They have to ensure that they balance their own chequebook. And basic financial background like that is sometimes a problem for many young men and women coming out of. I've got one constituent in particular. He actually got a military cross and then they made him redundant when he was in Afghanistan. But one of the things that happened was that he had a six-month binge. He had money because he'd been 6 tours in Iraq, 3 in Afghanistan. The army had looked after him during that period. When he actually came out of the armed forces, he went in an absolute six-month binge with all the money that he'd saved up during that period. Now, no doubt he had a fantastic 6 months, but then he had absolutely nothing. He went for housing, didn't know about how to pay all his bills, and had difficulty for a number of years. Luckily now, he is moving forward with his life, but that's not unusual. That isn't an unusual story with young men and women coming out of that, and that's something that the armed forces and as a society we need to look at to make sure that we are supporting these young people when they come out. You know, it's my belief, Presiding Officer, that we support our veterans as one of the factors that can judge us as a society. Earlier I mentioned my distant relative Stephen Gifford, and he was lucky enough to be pensioned off and travelled before settling in Paisley. But this is not the norm. As I've already mentioned, financial problems are always an issue when it comes to service personnel. and they find it very difficult to find that support. They do not all join the Legion and talk to the welfare officer. Many of them do not walk into my office and discuss their issues with me. And we need to find a way that we can actually find these young men, older men, young women, older women, and find a way that we can work with them to ensure that we can support them, because they have... Yes, I will do.
Christine Graham.
I can't, it's difficult, but I'll speak to you, but I'm really speaking, of course, to Mr Adam. Is it not the case, Mr Adam, that the MOD could actually do more to integrate that transition period into the community than they're doing at the moment? While everybody's got the good wishes, I do feel there's a role for the MOD here to ensure that that period of transition is smooth.
George Adam.
Yes, there definitely is, and to be fair to the MOD, they are actually trying to work on packages at the moment, but it's still not enough. We still have these young men and women who are having that difficulty, and I think that is one of the most important things. If we cannot ensure that these people can actually be part of life and just pay their bills and get on with it, then how are we going to actually say that we are supporting these people, these young or older service personnel? So I would close, Presiding Officer, by saying, you know, we have to ensure that when we're dealing, these people have actually defended their country, they've given the ultimate sacrifice in been out and gone to places where governments have told them to go, and you have to say that we need to make sure when they come back that we look after them, because to do so is how we are judged as a society and shows that we actually do care.
Many thanks. Before I call Rob Gibson, could I invite members who have participated in the debate to come back to the chamber for closing speeches, which will take place after Rob Gibson. Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be contributing to this debate on veterans, and as the motion from the government says, recognises the challenges facing veterans' transition to civilian life, but believe that their training, skills and sense of duty and discipline mean that employers and companies benefit greatly from employing veterans. And it's the report of the Veterans Commissioner in terms of employability support models that I want to concentrate on just now, because there are two sides to look at. There's the ability of the personnel about to be made redundant or returning to Civvy Street, and also the people who want to provide services for them that I want to concentrate on. So employability support models include the approaches which the Commissioner has suggested should be included in a personal development plan. And they need to get the information about the kinds of courses that are suited to their skills. And I understand, you know, basically that Careers Transition Partnership and LCAS, which sets the actual levels of the credit schemes and the costs of learning in nationally accredited schemes for veterans to take part in, is something which has to be geared up to Scottish conditions. And that's what the recommendation 12 says in this report, that the Scottish Government, its agencies, Scottish local authorities should work with the UK Government to ensure that the new personal development plan and related course models are relevant to those settling in Scotland. Well, I have a situation where I have a gentleman called Mike Ellis, who is able to provide the kinds of courses in the north of Scotland which help people with outdoor skills. He runs a one-man operation called Helmsdale Charcoal and Coppice, and it offers a woodsman course to level 3. And since this involves 5 days practical training, that requires residential work, which makes for another disadvantage for providing that course in the north of Scotland at Helmsdale, which is quite far along the Far North Railway line from Inverness or up the A9 just before you reach Caithness. But he has been offering these courses to individuals, and doing so perhaps because it recognises the potential for trainees to enjoy the skills of outdoor pursuits, which builds on the discipline and confidence in practical work that woodsmanship entails. Using hand tools in woodland settings can be very therapeutic, And the potential in the north of Scotland to provide this is a good example of a small business which is providing something for which there's a need. But there are difficulties in so doing. He is the only person in the UK that provides this course to level three. But the way in which the Careers Transition Partnership look at this, they tend to aim at very large providers. They don't necessarily aim at people who are geared up to providing fairly small courses, which of course could expand. But as Mr. Ellis says, when he talks to the careers transition people, he gets the feeling that he's told to show that there's a demand. Well, the point is, he can supply, but they've got to show what is possible to veterans to come and take advantage of courses like that. Now, his work is featured on BBC Scotland's Landward and on BBC's Countryfile programmes, because woodsmanship is something which is a great skill that's needed in many outdoor jobs that are very fitted for veterans to undertake. And indeed, across much of rural Scotland, there's a need with people with their skills, dedication and discipline. And I think that the development people do recognise this. You know, the one awards organisation which does accreditation and matches up English awards and Scottish awards have said, you know, that for the last 2 years, military personnel under their occupational resettlement or rehabilitation scheme, returning to duties, have been offered this course to develop their skills and experience to equip them to start their own woodsman and coppice businesses in other places. So we should try and encourage the potential for more of these kinds of skills to be built up for people to enjoy. And Mr. Ellis has been invited indeed to go to South Lanarkshire Council and offer his courses in that location for veterans who've become clear. So I'd like to put a plea in that when we're looking at the way in which the Scottish Government operates and coordinates this, that we recognise that in rural parts of Scotland there are potential courses and people out there who could be offering these that certainly want to be a part of this. When it says in the findings of the report by the Commissioner, if service leavers settling in Scotland are not to be disadvantaged, military skills must be mapped to Scottish qualifications. Well, I've dealt with that part, but there's a need to take a comprehensive look at the policies and support available in Scotland for opening access to further and higher education for service leavers of all ages. Well, I think Mr. Ellis is a good example of somebody who's providing this to level three, which is the best you can get. But with the disadvantages of his location, we've got to get over that and make sure that the support services in the personal development packages are given a chance to get to where these courses are. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I hope that's something that the government can take on board and that we can unite behind.
Many thanks. That then brings us to the closing speeches. And I call on Jackson Carlaw. 7 minutes, please, Mr. Carlaw.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This has actually been a hugely enjoyable afternoon. It's been a very constructive debate, and I've very much enjoyed listening to the contributions from all sides of the chamber. Can I begin just with assistance to the clerks, who have been somewhat discombobulated, I think, by my assertion that I might have been a teenager when the film The Shawshank Redemption came out. And while it's certainly true that for most Conservatives of a certain age, life did begin in 1979, and I would only have been 15 at the time, it isn't altogether fair to suggest that I was a teenager at that point. I would also, you know, like to thank Mr. Maxwell and Mr. Crawford for their reference to my flying around in biplanes and Sopworth camels. Were that true, I would also want to thank Mr. Maxwell for all the many years of experience he brought to servicing those aircraft at the time. I was very amused and by George Adams' contribution as well. You know, my first introduction, again, I have to say this time as a teenager, to the military triumphs of Paisley was a fictional account by George MacDonald Fraser of the life of Harry Flashman, who I remember reading with some entertainment. The first wench, I think, as he put it, that he picked up was on the grass just outside Paisley Abbey. Now, were it not a fictional account, I might well have believed that the very rakish antecedents of Mr. Adam actually found their favour in that exchange, but maybe it was allegoric. This, moving aside to the substance of the debate, I would like to touch on the Labour amendment, because I had actually said nothing about that in my introductory remarks, expecting to hear a little bit more about the development of the narrative supporting it. And I realise, in fact, Mr. McIntosh is going to deal with this in the summation that's coming up. But can I say that I think there are a number of colleagues around the chamber who are actually slightly uncomfortable at the idea that we might end up in a division later on this evening. And while I'm very sympathetic to the sentiments underpinning it, I actually think that it is slightly more complicated. I think there is a UK government dynamic in this as well as a Scottish government one. I think there are conversations taking place. And I too would very much appreciate not being put in that position, because I don't think in any event it actually advances matters. But I leave that for Mr. McIntosh to develop in his closing argument. There have been a lot of very considerably speeches I enjoyed. I'd like to return to Mike McKenzie, because normally Mr. McKenzie is a bastion of what I call partisan invective towards me on this side of the chamber. And yet today I thought he made a hugely positive and compelling contribution on employment. And in previous debates, which have talked about rehabilitation of offenders into society, I have touched upon the fact that, having been in the Scottish motor trade for 25 years, I did think there was an obligation on employers, if one believed in the principle of rehabilitation of offenders, to create opportunities for offenders in businesses that offered careers that were appropriate. And it occurs to me that perhaps we should have a more proactive approach to employers to seek to get a body who would look to participate in that development that Mr. Gibson talked about of personal development plans that are appropriate. Now, I think of the Scottish Motor Trade Association, organisations like that presided over by Sir Arnold Clarke that have a representation across the whole of Scotland in communities with a very variable mix of employment opportunities. And I'm being, I suppose, slightly narrow here in looking at what are traditionally male areas of employment. But there is within those organisations, I always felt within the retail motor industry, which I was involved in, again, quite a structured camaraderie, discipline, and structured approach to the development of a multiplicity of different types of careers. And I just wonder whether we might, not just within the retail motor industry, but beyond that, be trying to look to a broader list of employers. Because I think many would prove willing if they thought that they were contributing in some way to the armed forces community re-entering society to participate within such a structure. There were some very strong contributions on the whole subject of mental health. And I think it's important, and Joe McAlpine talked at length about post-traumatic stress, which is absolutely key. But of course, the mental health issue is typical of the one that more generally prevails in society. Very often it is simply depression. Depression which has grown out of the difficulties and challenges faced by those re-entering society, not getting access to employment opportunities, not getting access to housing. And although we have spoken very constructively this afternoon and positively, and I think rightly so, I suppose a little acid in the drink might also reflect that too many of our ex-servicemen do end up in custodial sentences. Too many of them are those who have been registered as homeless. Too many of them are those who suffer complicated issues arising from access to alcohol, again, arising from the kind of depression and general mental health issues that prevail. And I think there's a huge responsibility on us to accept that there needs to be investment in services which, to some extent, are slightly more specialised than those that those generally suffering from those conditions might have. I did touch on the subject of charitable status, because I think this is something we need to recognise. When I talked earlier about the whole difference in the way the public perception of the armed forces has grown, it has also led to a tremendous rise in charitable giving to armed forces charities. Many have been set up for the very best of reasons, but perhaps will not prove to be sustainable going forward, because the reality is, as we move beyond this period when so much has been open and demonstrably apparent to us in terms of parades and the armed services and the sustainability with the Armed Forces Day that we have in the summer that brings that home. Some of these charities are not going to be able to sustain themselves, and it will be a difficult and uncomfortable conversation, but it is one that I think as politicians we may have to be prepared to participate and lead in, that a number of these charities will probably have to amalgamate and merge and be carefully targeted going forward if we are not to find that some of them get into all sorts of difficulties which become quite counterproductive and very unfortunate. And I think that is a huge responsibility going forward. As charitable giving may start to decline, the huge amount of money that that has created may lessen slightly, and again the responsibility for governments in the future, because the responsibility towards veterans will extend into the future, will be one that I think we will have to be prepared to meet, and a challenge to which we will have to rise. But it's been a very constructive debate this afternoon. We'll be supporting the main motion, and I thank all members who participated.
Many thanks, and I now call on Ken McIntosh. Mr McIntosh, 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I begin, as I think many have, by welcoming this report on transition in Scotland from the Scottish Veterans Commissioner. It's clear that there's nothing in this report which any of the parties across the chamber would take exception to, and there are a number of very sensible recommendations which we look forward to the government taking forward. What's even more clear is the warmth and the respect expressed by every single member this afternoon towards our armed forces, our early service leavers and our veterans. And I think it's also true that nearly every single member told a personal story, either about themselves, their family or someone they knew. And that reveals, I think, the emotional connection and the empathy that we have for those veterans. Now, there are issues flagged up in the report and which need to be addressed around housing, employment and health. And this was reflected in a number of the contributions. I think Christine Graham talked about the need to tackle the problems created by alcohol dependency. Jane Baxter pointed to the need for more as well as better housing, and Graham Day highlighted the work of Glasgow Caledonian University in improving veterans' education and qualifications. But what also struck me were the many examples quoted of good practice, particularly from our local authorities and from the third sector in Scotland, in this report. The support offered our veterans from the City of Glasgow, for example, was singled out for praise, and I'm sure not a surprise to many of my colleagues representing that city. I had the good fortune to visit Bellrock Close in Cranhill recently, a fantastic new housing support service in the east end of Glasgow, run in partnership with others by the Scottish Veterans Housing Association on behalf of Scottish Veterans Residences. Bellrock Close provides exceptionally high quality accommodation, but it is also very much geared at providing the transitional support, which is the subject of this afternoon's debate. Every veteran has a dedicated key worker and a support team to help them access additional services in areas such as health, welfare benefits, further education, volunteering and job searches, up to the point where a future home in the community is secured and the veteran is ready to move on. It was clear to me from speaking to residents that they hugely valued and benefited from this service. I was also pleased to see an acknowledgement in the Commissioner's report of the role and the importance of having high-profile public champions providing political leadership. In my own local authority of East Renfrewshire, I know Council Leader Jim Fletcher is particularly active in promoting the interests of ex-service personnel. The Council has worked with other authorities, Renfrewshire and Inverclyde in particular, all jointly training their customer service advisers to ask the right questions to identify veterans and then to signpost them to specialist advice services for housing, employment, benefits or medical treatment. I should also add that in that task they are ably supported in my own constituency by the local Citizens Advice Scotland Bureau. I think this is a point that Bruce Crawford brought up with the ASAP service provided in his constituency. And in our area, we have a specialist veterans advisor in the CAB. Other members today drew attention to a number of very welcome initiatives. I think Dave Stewart talked about the Armed Forces Parliamentary Scheme, although I'm not sure whether he was trying to encourage us or put us off with the idea of a flight in a tornado. I would thank Stuart Maxwell again for highlighting Armed Forces Legal Advice, the discounted legal service started by Alan Steele, which I think is did an excellent amount of work and is about to be expanded into America, my understanding. So I would thank all members for their contribution, and today's report from the Veterans Commissioner, along with this afternoon's debate, provides many examples of good practice and encouragement, as well as an analysis of what's needed to do if we're to properly support former members of armed forces as they move into civilian life. No matter how consensual our debate and how much agreement there is across this chamber, however, I think it would be wrong to have a debate on veterans in Scotland in the Parliament today without even a reference to the insult to injury campaign launched by Poppy Scotland and the Royal British Legion in January this year. And I think most members will have received at least one, if not more, letters from veterans affected. And just to recap or outline the essence of this campaign, veterans who were injured in service on or before the 5th of April 2005 receive a war disablement pension. Those with a similar injury but who were injured on or after 6th of April 2005 receive compensation under the Armed Forces Compensation Scheme. There is widespread variation across Scotland as to whether those injured veterans are able to keep all their compensation or whether they are expected to use those payments to pay for care. Having conducted a comprehensive survey, Poppy Scotland believe that only a third of war disablement pensions are fully disregarded, a figure that the Minister quoted a few minutes ago. There is also variation between the treatment of war pensioners injured before 2005 and those veterans injured since and in receipt of the Armed Forces compensation. Put bluntly, an injury from the Falklands conflict seems to count for less than one suffered in Afghanistan. Now, the Scottish Government's own guidance for residential care suggests that government take all but the first £10 a week of a veteran's compensation. This doesn't compare very well to the situation in the rest of the UK, where at least the Armed Forces Compensation Scheme, those payments are disregarded. And it's also worth highlighting that by comparison, local authorities are required to exempt compensation that has been awarded to civilians who have been injured in the workplace. The British Legion and Poppy Scotland can see no reason, and I have to say I fully agree with them, for the disparity in the way that injured veterans and war pensioners are currently treated within the social care system. And I'm sure there's no one in this chamber either who believes it fair that disabled war pensioners should be treated differently to other injured veterans. And I'm also sure there's no one here who thinks it's acceptable that war pensioners should be treated less favourably than civilians who have been injured in the workplace. This latter point in particular demonstrates that the current situation is in breach of the Armed Forces Covenant, which states that the service personnel, veterans and their families should not be left disadvantaged as a result of military service. I would point out on an encouraging note that since the launch of the Insult to Injury campaign, many local authorities have looked or are looking at their own charging practices and at their own discretionary powers. I'm delighted to report that in my own local authority, they have agreed to abolish any charges they might levy on veterans living in East Renfrewshire. It's so clearly the right thing to do. Poppy Scotland are calling on the Scottish Government not just to harmonise the way that local authorities treat the two military compensation schemes, but to revise existing charging guidelines so that all local authorities are required to fully disregard war disablement pensions for means tests for social care. Now, I understand the Minister's point and also from Jackson Carlow's contribution. Can I just say, by the way, I thoroughly enjoyed Jackson Carlow's both opening and concluding contributions. I'm sure that all members recognise that military compensation is awarded as recompense for the pain, suffering and loss experienced by injured service personnel and veterans. And although I'm slightly disappointed that we can't all unite around our amendment, I would ask the Minister, if he can, in his summing up, to tell Parliament what progress he intends to make on this issue and perhaps when he'll report back to Parliament. And in the light of his remarks, I certainly hope that my Labour colleagues and I would be able to ask the presiding officer if we could withdraw our amendment. Now, I certainly wouldn't wish to take any of that discussion away from the highly consensual debate we have had and the practical steps we can take. Earlier in the debate, my colleague Mary Fee talked about the importance of not discussing veterans as if they were a game of political football. Now, I'm going to take the brave step of disagreeing with Mary, and the Minister may know what's coming next. Every year, to celebrate Armed Forces Day, which falls on the 27th of June, the parliamentary team organise a game of football against RAF veterans. Yes, it's the RAF again, Mr Crawford. Last year, Raith Rovers were generous enough to accommodate us as part of their celebration or commemorations, I should say, of the centenary of the Great War. Unfortunately, the RAF were a little bit too strong last year, and we need to call up our own reserves for this year's fixture. As a reliable right-back, or was it right midfield, I would ask the Minister if he's willing to pencil at least in the fixture. We're looking at the morning of June the 12th, and any other members in the Chamber who fancied the chance to display their talents in a good cause, please let me know, Mr MacArthur in particular. Presiding Officer, the Commissioner concluded his report by calling us to look at veterans as an asset to our communities rather than simply as people in need, a point made by the Minister, by Dave Stewart, by Lee MacArthur and many others. That's a good message we can unite around, and we are pleased to support the first report of the Scottish Veterans Commissioner.
Thank you very much, and I now call upon Keith Brown to respond to the debate. Cabinet Secretary, we have a little bit of time in hand, so I can give you until 5 o'clock. Thank you.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm grateful to members for, as others have said, what's been a very constructive and thought-provoking debate today. It's certainly given some of the suggestions given me further food for thought, and I, of course, they will be of great interest to the Scottish Veterans Commissioner, Eric Fraser, as he continues to take forward his work. The Commissioner's future work will significantly shape what we take forward, either as a Scottish Government or in partnership with our strategic partners and members. We'll be aware that in previous debates around support for the armed forces community in Scotland, I have rehearsed what had been delivered, what is in train, what will be examined, what will be explored and developed. But members will also know that certainly I've come to the Chamber and reported on progress and pointed to a contribution to the UK Government annual report on the Armed Forces Covenant. In that regard, it's fair to say that our input into that document has been widely acknowledged and welcomed by the MOD, by the military, veterans organisations and the wider armed forces and veterans community. And I should say this, and I suppose I would say this anyway, but there's a great deal of regard around the rest of the UK for what we've managed to achieve in terms of veterans in Scotland. Members have been here longer than I may remember. There's a very critical report, I think, in 2007, from the Health Committee of the House of Commons, which was not at all complimentary of the services which our veterans received. And I think we've come a long way since that time. We've reported back on what we've done. We've always done that against the backdrop of our own 2012 policy document, Our Commitments, which I had the pleasure to launch at Edinburgh Castle on the 5th of September 2012. And members may recall that document set out in some detail what initiatives and programmes were being pursued across the Scottish Government within our devolved responsibilities. Now under the day-to-day control of the Director General for Education and Justice, Leslie Evans, in her capacity as Armed Forces Advocate. Our commitments was always intended to be a baseline document around which the Scottish Government pushed new initiatives and work streams in support of the Armed Forces, veterans and their families. In that work, she has been ably and enthusiastically supported by external organisations such as Poppy Scotland, Legion Scotland and, of course, Veterans Scotland, with whom I meet on a quarterly basis. And of course, our work is also heavily influenced by the Scottish Veterans Commissioner. For that reason, it's my view that it's time to refresh our commitments, to give it more impetus and focus, to address the range of new ideas, actions and challenges identified through the work of the Commissioner and our ongoing discussions with our partners. Some of the suggestions, in fact, made today by Rob Gibson and others. One very good suggestion I heard when over at Tartan Week in Canada recently, where they said that there's an app which you can have in New Zealand and Australia, which, if you've been in the armed forces, tells you where all the veterans are, the ones that want to subscribe to it, around the Commonwealth. So if you've served alongside the Australian Army and you happen to be in Australia, you can find your colleagues from that time. An excellent idea. So we will look at these new ideas as well as some of the ones which have been mentioned today. I've asked the officials to embark on a programme of work to update our commitments with a view to publication in early 2016. And in parallel with that, I'll continue to highlight, promote and stress that the vast majority of men and women who serve in our armed forces do so with honour, with distinction and pride, and they bring that full range of skills that they've honed during their service into civilian life and are valuable assets to our communities. I think, like Jackson Carlow, I thought that the way that Mike McKenzie spoke about the qualities of the veterans that he'd worked with, and also identified that very important thing of self-discipline, which I think the armed forces are very good at instilling in people, and I think is probably the most, to my mind, enduring quality which they can offer through the training and the ethos of the armed forces. As I say, veterans are employees, they're employers, they're entrepreneurs and volunteers. On a previous visit to Canada, I also saw a very strong programme of veterans being encouraged to move into franchising as entrepreneurs. And that appeals to veterans in many ways, the idea of being in charge of yourself, but having a structure within which to work. So I look to our strategic partners to help us with this task. I know that the military, Veterans Scotland and the wider ex-service charitable sector and the Families Federations, so helpful before and now, fully endorsed that stance. And I think the person, I think it may have been
Graham Day that mentioned families in particular. I think that's really now coming really into focus. People are realising that much of the issues that we deal with in terms of veterans really should apply in many cases to consideration for their families. You know, people have talked about veterans actually in Graham Day's constituency going from 4-5 commando to do 3-4 tours in Afghanistan. What they don't often appreciate is that will be preceded each time by a 6 or 7 month training period when the service personnel are away from their families, and many of them find those training periods more stressful actually than Afghanistan, because they're forced to be removed from their families. So we have to concentrate on the effect it has on families. And just to come back to some of the points which are raised, Mary Fee quite rightly raised the issues of transition. I think she asked whether we've examined these up to now. We do generally, and we did provide a response to the report produced by Lord Ashcroft, which tackled this. Much of the responsibility lies with the armed forces. We'd like to have perhaps a more constructive relationship with the MOD, whether it's
Minister, can I stop you slightly for a moment? I'm sorry about that. Could we have the back door closed over? Thank you. I can hear noise. Minister.
So we have looked at that, and we'll continue to look at that. I think it was quite a useful report that was produced by Lord Ashcroft, and it identifies a number of areas. As I've said before, I do think the armed forces should very much look at, starting from day one of somebody's service career, to look at housing. What are they going to do when they come out of housing? There are some, but not enough, and not substantial enough schemes, for example, to give support for those who want to buy a house when they're armed forces. Those schemes are not nearly widely well enough known. In terms of education or going to a future job, I think a great deal could be done to structure your career in the armed forces to make sure you've got the best chance of a career when you come out. So we've made these points in the past. I was going to mention Jackson Carlow's reference to being a teenager and watching Shawshank Redemption, but perhaps it's due to the fact that I am of a similar age that I couldn't quite remember how long ago it was that Shawshank Redemption came out. I know it's actually a favourite of my son, and I know exactly the scene that he's talking about. It was a scene when the guy that had been in prison for nearly all of his life came out and actually ended up forcing himself back into the prison because that's where he felt more comfortable, and eventually took his own life, I think, because of that institution which he'd been so used to. Now, that is not, and I know Jackson Carlow was not trying to portray veterans in any way as similar to people that are in prison, but it is true to say that structure, having a structure round about you, presents one of the biggest challenges for our veterans. I think it was Stuart Maxwell that mentioned the fire service, and he was right to say I went to the fire service, and the person that was in charge, I'm not sure exactly what his rank was within the fire service, said that he had been told early on in his career always to try and ensure there was a smattering of veterans in his force, because he reckoned they provided such a stable and productive and reliable element to the fire service, calm under pressure, that was essential to a good fire service. I mentioned Tartan Week. We also went to New York to see the Veterans Affairs, Veterans Benefits Agency in New York whilst we were there. And what struck me, which we don't do in this country, was when they provided support after somebody had left. Certainly, yep.
Stuart Maxwell.
It just strikes me when you're talking about the fire service and the good fit between the fire service and ex-forces personnel. And I certainly share that view and mentioned it in my own contribution. I just wondered if the Minister was aware of any effective groups that operate, so that effectively you can take very clear, obvious routes into employment, like the fire service and other organisations that are very suited to some members of the forces. Are they linking into the MOD and the forces before those personnel leave? Because I think one of the problems that other members have mentioned is this disconnect between the point at which they leave and then trying to get them into employment. And I would think that connections between organisations like the fire service and the military, while they're still in the military, would be quite a good way of giving that smooth transition that we've all been talking about.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I think it's a good point. Perhaps the way that I've seen that most actively produced actually is an area that Jackson Carlow identified, which is in the motor trade. First Bus, for example, have a very good scheme to make sure mainly mechanics. But one of the events one of the things we found out at the event, the cross-party reception, was that there's a real shortage in the country of HGV drivers, and you get a lot of qualified HGV drivers coming out of the military. So just to affect that straightforward transition, also in relation, in fact, to telecommunications and technicians, telecommunications and IT skilled individuals, you get many of them coming into our forces, and we have a real skill issue with getting as many of those people into the workforce. So we are working on that, the point that Stuart Maxwell made, and it's done better, I think, in some other countries. The UK government's trying to address this through the corporate covenant, and we're doing one or two things here to try and make sure it develops in Scotland as well. I would just say, coming back to Hanzala Malik's point, we don't have the intention of expanding the concessionary travel scheme in the way that he suggests. That would cost tens of millions of pounds. It's a very serious proposition. I understand he meant it in good faith, but that's not our proposal at this time. The point that Christine Graham made, we have looked at this already. I think we need some more detail, perhaps from her, about Persimmon Homes and the actual scheme. But I do undertake to take that up with colleagues in relation to the apprenticeship scheme and how we can make that work better for veterans. There's many other members that made some tremendous contributions, and apologies if I can't mention them all. But just to estimate, if I can, underline, Presiding Officer, before we finish, that the actual reality in this country is that veterans are an invaluable asset to employers, to the community in Scotland. I think we had the flavour from the debate that most members, all members, I think, share that view, although they did not want to gloss over, quite rightly, some of the challenges which a small number of veterans face, and we should continue to provide support there. But I would just ask that those members of the Parliament who have shared that view about the benefits of veterans to society do try to undertake, on a personal level, to communicate that whenever they can, because that should really be the story. It's a key plank of the Commissioner's report that we've discussed today, and I hope it's very much that it's the beginning of that process of trying to put the message out there, especially even for our veterans themselves. They often do not appreciate some of the skills and some of the training that they've had and its relevance to civilian life. And sometimes, I think, again, Graham Day mentioned the point about self-esteem, a very important point. I think there's a great deal we can do. Jackson Carlow was right as well to say that we do have the benefits just now where there's very popular support for veterans, and people now are able to distinguish the service of veterans from the places they've been sent to by politicians, which is very important. I don't think we can take that for granted in future. So I think we have to continue to work on that. And for my part, I would give my assurance that the Scottish Government will continue to strive to do everything that we can to support those that have served our country so well. So that's not just those that need our help in terms of employment, in terms of health, in terms of education. But it's those that don't need our help necessarily, but they need our support. We should be the advocates for our veterans when they come back into society as real assets to companies around the country. The main point of today's debate is to highlight the extent to which they continue to do that. They've transitioned from civilian life,
please,
and produce tremendous work in the various fields in which they go into once they've come out of civilian life. We have to make sure we help those that find it a challenge, but we should also make sure that we give credit to those that come out of the armed forces and play a productive role in our society. Thank you very much.
Many thanks, Cabinet Secretary, and that concludes the debate on making the most of the contribution of veterans to Scotland. Before we move to decision time, can I call on Mary Fee to speak, please?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to be given this opportunity. I think we've had a very good debate this afternoon, very consensual and very positive, and following on from the very constructive comments made by the Cabinet Secretary, to work with members across the Chamber to resolve the issues around social care, I would seek leave of the Chamber to withdraw my amendment. Thank you.
Many thanks. The member is seeking leave to withdraw her amendment. Does any member object? Since no member objects, the amendment is therefore withdrawn, and we will now move to decision time. There will be one question to be put as a result of today's business, and the question is that motion 13045 in the name of Keith Brown on making the most of the contribution of veterans to Scotland be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and that concludes decision time, and I now close this meeting of Parliament.